Today is March 23rd, 1998. Survivor Rabbi Zalman Schacter-Shalomi, last name at birth Schachter, interviewer Lori Feiner Goldberg, in Boulder, Colorado, in the United States of America. The language is English.
My name is Lori, L-O-R-I, Feiner, F-E-I-N-E-R, Goldberg, G-O-L-D-B-E-R-G. I have the honor today of conducting an interview with Rabbi Zalman Schacter-Shalomi in Boulder, Colorado, in the United States of America. The date is March 23, 1998.
Please give me your name.
Zalman, Meshulam Zalman, Reb Shlomo HaKohen. That's how I'm called up to the Torah. I recently added the name Chia to my name. So it is now Meshulam Zalman Chia, Reb Shlomo HaKohen. Schachter is the last name. And added to this is Shalomi now.
What was your name at birth?
Zalman Schachter.
Can you spell that, please?
Z-A-L-M-A-N-S-C-H-A with an umlaut on top. C-H again, T-E-R.
What is your birth date?
August 17, 1924.
And where were you born?
In Żółkiew, Poland.
Can you spell that?
Z, well, depending how you'd go. Some people put an H after the Z. O-L-K-I-E-W, Żółkiew, and it was in eastern Ukraine, or rather eastern Galicia, which is western Ukraine.
And what is your age today?
73 and some.
What were your maternal grandparents' names?
Chashe was the grandmother. She is the mother of my mother, Chaya Gittel. And she was of the Ettinger clan, E-T-T-I-N-G-E-R, also in Żółkiew. And they were Belzer Hasidim.
What is the origin of their last name?
Ettingen is a town in Swabia where Jews came from before they came to Poland. And it was a rabbinic family by that name, sometimes spelled Ettinger, E-T-T-I-N-G, sometimes Oettinger, O-E, umlaut, you know, and so on.
What languages did they speak?
They needed to speak Polish with officials, Ukrainian, Chochlatsky was the way in which they pronounced it, with the people with whom they traded. German was a kind of, people called it Kongressdeutsch, you know, sort of a Yiddish that was made more German sounding. That was their German. And those are the languages they spoke. My mother, in addition to that, also spoke Hebrew.
What was your maternal grandfather's name? You gave me your grandmother. What about your grandfather?
The grandfather's name was Meshulam Zalman. He came from the family Yagid. And he, as I understand it, was a merchant, but he didn't have much time to do any of these things because when the war broke out in 1914, he was drafted. And sometimes in 1915, he was killed in the battlefield. He received a bullet and blood poisoning set in the hospital. So it was not immediate that he died.
You said your mother's name was Chaya Gittel. Where was she born?
Chaya Gittel was born also in Żółkiew.
What was her family like?
In the good days, the family, the Ettingers, Reimanns, Yagids, were somehow the elite, like Bobby used to say, Hasidish, Negidish, and Balabatish. It was her way of saying it was a Hasidic family, it was sort of a well-to-do family, and decent burgers. Yeah.
What type of education did your mother receive?
Mother went to, first she had a melamed, and then she went to the school of the Matechkes. Matechke is a way of saying the mothers, meaning the nuns, where she studied whatever people did in primary grades. But because it was in those days still part of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, German was one of the important languages, so she took German and Polish.
What was your mother's occupation?
When?
Whatever.
When all through her life. Well, for a while, when she was good as a seamstress, and when she first came to Vienna, they opened a little shop in which they had remnants of textile goods, and she would sew some things like a dressmaker would for people and complete them, so they would come in and buy the material and then tell her what they wanted to have made, and she would make it for them. That form of work was with her all her life, because when we came to the United States later on, and that's a whole story about how we got into the fur business, she would finish the garments and work on the fur. So at times she would complete the linings and the pipings and all the stuff inside the coats. She was also a good businesswoman. And later on, when the fur and her asthma did not work well together, and they moved to Phoenix, they went into producing neckties. That too had to do with sewing and with textile. That was sort of, until she retired, was her work.
What is your strongest memory of your mother?
Lighting candles on Friday night. Seeing mother with her, then she would have put on a kerchief. Usually she wore her hair open and free. But for lighting candles, she would put on a kerchief. And there would be a great devotional thing as she would invoke the light of the Shabbos candles and then pray. And it would always take her some time to pray. When I was a child and I walked by a church, sort of a side chapel of a church, I noticed that the women there too had babushkas on and were doing stuff with candles. So I came to the conclusion that all men are Jewish and all women are Catholic. I mean, sort of, yeah.
What were your paternal grandparents' names?
Zede Shiadov Hakoyen. He was a shochet in Oshvitsin. That is in the western part of Galicia, later on was known as Auschwitz. Uspitzin, sometimes spelled in when you spelled it out in Yiddish, in Hebrew letters. And his last name was Graf. Shia Shoichet Graf. And Bobby was Lifshe. And him I only saw for a few hours in all my life that I could remember. When I was a child, of course, a baby, and then I know that he played with me and so on, but I don't remember that. And I did not see Bobby Lifshe in this lifetime. Later on when I grew up, also in early times, I must have seen her.
What languages did they speak?
Yiddish. And also, come back to the maternal great-grandmother. Her name was Babi Rezale, and she came to Vienna, and since my parents wanted to make sure that I would stick to German, so this was my Muttersprache, and so I did not speak Yiddish yet. Yiddish was what my parents spoke behind my back, and when they didn't want me to understand, or when I got to understand it a little better, they would switch to Polish. But Eltabobe, the great grandmother Reisele, spoke to me in Yiddish and said, "Zugno mein Kind, dat hat ich luchter." Tell me, my dear child, does your father ever hit you? And I said to her, "Wie bitte, gnädige Urgroßmutter?" What was that, my dear gracious great grandmother? Because I couldn't understand the Yiddish. So German was my Muttersprache, but as Bobbe Reisele, I still remember.
What do you know about your father's parents?
Among the people who were Belze Hasidim, Shia Shoichet was considered to be a very special, a gehoibene Yid, an exalted Jew. And he would travel from time to time to the Belze Rebbe, where he was honored. And also both his father and his father-in-law were Belze Hasidim. And both of them were Shochtim. So it was Schachter, that being Shochtim was the nomen professionalis of being in the family.
What was your father's name?
Shloime HaKoyen. Zalman Schacter was the name that he had in German. Shlomo. People called him Shloime. In a very friendly way. He had, when he came to Vienna, running away from the Polish conscription, he didn't want to serve in the Polish army, so he crossed over to Austria, settled in Vienna, and with his nadan, with his dowry that he received at the marriage of my mother, he bought a share in a business that was making soap and candles. His idea was that he wanted to have to do with cleanliness and with light, and figured that this was a good business. The business went bankrupt, and for years I remember when my mother would make bundles of the textiles for customers, she would wrap them and tie them up in wicking from those candles that was left over.
Where was your father born?
He was born in Krakowice. Krakowice is a small town, and I don't quite know where it was, apparently not too far from Auschwitz, but I don't have any details on it.
When was he born?
He was born the third day of Sukkot in 1898.
What type of education did he receive?
Cheder, largely in Cheder. They didn't have yeshivas in Galicia. What happened was that you would study, you'd have a malamed, and then you would sit, once you were on your own and you could study on your own, you went to the Bismedrish and studied on your own. You would have chevrusa, and there would be some people there with whom you would study together. From time to time, you would go and get fahered. Somebody would listen to what you have learned and test you. And that's what he did for a number of years. And then as soon as he was getting into shiduchim, meaning getting ready to be married, he had to prove that he could go and earn a living. So he would begin to deal in feathers, down and so on. So that was his business. He would travel around and get from various places a load of feathers that would then later on be washed, refined, and used for stuffing pillows.
What is your strongest memory of your father?
Interesting. Again, davening. You know, just as you're talking about mother, I see her davening with the candles, Papa under the talis. I still remember, I must have been about 6 years old or something, that I looked at Papa when he was leading in davening in his place, and I lifted up the talus to look at him, and there were tears in his eyes. And I said, "Why are you crying?" He says, "I was talking to God." Then I said, "Does it hurt when you talk to God?" He said, "No, it doesn't hurt. It just feels very good, but a little bit it hurts that you didn't talk to him sooner." Yeah.
Do you know how your parents met?
Shidduch. two Belzer families, you know, and there's always a Shatran in between who knows, "Oy, have I got a good match for your son or for your daughter?" And then they were brought together, I suppose, the two Mechutonim. What happened was that my mother didn't have anyone to stand in for her. So there was an uncle who was Mendel Ettinger, who was in charge of those big family affairs. It wasn't Mendel. Mendel was the great-grandfather. Don't remember his name right now. He was the one on the Ettinger side. And so she is Shoichet, and that uncle were brought together by the Shatchonim, talked, and then the two of them, my father and my mother, met.
Do you have any siblings?
Yes. I have a brother, Yosef Chaim. He is a rabbi, now retired in Jerusalem. And he was 6 years younger than I, and his sister Dvorah, 8 years younger than I, lives in Jerusalem, Beit Vegan, with her husband, also named Shlomo. It's a wonderful family, and so does my brother Joe. I also had a sister, Ada Tamar, who passed on about 4 or 5 years ago.
What were they like when you were growing up?
What were they like? He was always the one that got into my way. Devora was my buddy, and Ada was his buddy. So we had sort of this kind of an arrangement. He protected Ada, and I protected Devora. Over whom he would want to lord it. So that's how we had our sibling arrangement made.
In what city did you grow up in?
I grew up in Vienna, in the second precinct in Vienna, the Zweite Bezirk. Austrians called that section of Vienna the Matze Insel, the Matze Island. That's where most of the Jewish institutions were located. Yes, you had Jews all over Vienna, and there were different synagogues, but the main ghetto, if you will, was in the second precinct. The 20th precinct was sort of the suburb of the second in that respect, as far as Jews were concerned. When I got back to Vienna, couple of times after the war, the second precinct was again the place where Jews were. Apparently the buildings were still, they could recover some of the buildings. And one of the schools I attended was at this time watched by Austrian police, because they're always worried now in Europe that access to synagogues and so on, always very much protected. You have to be known by people to be let in, because they're afraid of attacks.
When did you move from your place of birth?
I must have been about a half a year old when my mother took me, because it was after Papa had crossed the border and gone to Vienna. There were other members of the family there, and so they arranged for a very small room, a cabinet, they called it, in the house of the Ettingers. Yankel Ettinger was an uncle. He was a brother of my Bubby, Chashe. And his business was doing things with liqueurs, alcohols, and so on and so forth, creating drinks out of these. And his business was right adjacent to my parents' store. And in that little room in there, in the Ettinger house, this is where I spent my first 3 years.
Describe the home in detail that you grew up in.
Well, there were several homes. After I was 3 years old, my parents found a place across the street where the store was, on the Tandelmarktgasse. I recently came across a book of old Vienna and the ghetto of Vienna, and there was a picture of that house in which I was raised from the age of three on. You walked in through the main entrance, a wooden, heavy wooden gate. I remember it was locked at night. And you walked into the courtyard, and then you came up on some outside steps, as we would find now in New York on a fire escape-like, outside steps going to the second floor. On that level of the second floor, there was a toilet that wasn't even a flush toilet. And there was a single sink for a cold water sink. And we had two rooms. The first one was a kitchen, and the other one was a living and bedroom. I suppose it was cozy, but I don't have nice memories of that place. I remember being sick and having fever once, and my parents both had to be at work, and there wasn't even a babysitter. I was all by myself, and I, in the fever, had seen images from the wood moiré pattern coming out that frightened me, and I was crying. Yeah, these are memories that I have from that house. They weren't too happy. When my brother was born, we moved into another place. This was of Hollandstrasse 2, very close to the Danube Canal, which sort of one arm of the Danube. And people used to call it a Zinskaserne, a rent armory. In other words, it's a huge building with tenements in there. And we were on the fourth or fifth floor of that tenement house. I don't remember exactly how you would count them. I think if the ground floor is a first, that would be the fifth floor. And there we had three rooms. It was the kitchen, the cabinet, and the main room, which was bedroom and dining room and so on.
What was a typical family dinner like?
Typical family dinners didn't happen except on Shabbos and on Yom Tov, because my parents were at work, and there was a little gas stove where they worked, and so whatever they would have as their meal, they would take along to the store and warm it up. Shabbos was different. Papa would put on his Morgenrock, which is his morning coat, which I remember didn't have buttons but had frogs. And that impressed me all the time. And when he put that on and would begin to make Kiddush, say Shalom Aleichem, the angels, Papa slipped into a whole other mode of being. During the week, he was a pretty hard-working man, but Shabbos, he was a king. And when Mama saw him in the Morgenrock, you know, she was beaming too.
Do you recall a favorite food from when you were growing up?
I liked a lot of stuff that Mama made. Chvetschenknödel I loved the most. Those were dumplings of potato dumplings that would have potato flour dumplings that would have prunes or plums inside, rolled in breadcrumbs and sugar. Oh, they were the cat's meow. But I liked everything. I really enjoyed food a lot, whether it was a soup of Shabbos or the chicken. For Sundays, it was something really special, the meatballs and potatoes that Mama made.
Who were your friends?
That kept on changing, depending often on the school and my interests at that time. The warmest friendships that I could remember were with people who were in the later years. When I went to gymnasium and to the yeshiva in the afternoon. Yoshi Lazar was one of them. Nathan Felig, Avram Monheit. See, these are the names that have come up in my mind as I remembered them. In fact, only 2 weeks ago, I had a chance to talk to Avram Monheit because someone from Miami who is working in the eldering work came and told me that she had just worked with a client who remembered me yet from Vienna and gave me a phone number, and we talked on the telephone. It was just lovely.
Describe the games you played.
Well, again, there were the early games which I didn't like in Spielschule, kindergarten. They had counting games, and so whoever was left, the last one counted out, and everybody went like this. And is die schwarze Köchin da? Ja, ja, ja. And so I would be left at this one and would get a terrible headache when I was the one counted out. I loved to be, later on, Vienna was Fußball, which means soccer. And that was of great interest to me because there was even a Jewish team known as the Hakoach, and there was another one of Maccabees, you know, and so, of course, you were rooting for them. And we would, from time to time, go out and play soccer, and the kind of almost self-sacrifice for doing a goal, you know, or preventing a goal from the other people, jumping in such ways to intercept the ball that could kill you, but these were some of the sports that we did.
We'll continue on the next tape. Tape 2, Rabbi Zalman Schacter-Shalomi. Did you have non-Jewish friends?
This sort of gives me a little churning in the belly. Yes, there was one of them. And later on, he became a Hitler youth and made me do deep knee bends in front of the store with a sign, of a Jewish store with a sign, Arya kauft nicht beim Juden. Aryans don't you buy from a Jew. And I had shared my lunches with him in school. And he came from a poor family. And none of that counted later on, so I just had bad feelings. Most of my friends were Jewish. It didn't. Second Precinct was that kind of a place too. I went to Jewish schools. I went to gymnasium, to yeshiva. There were very few opportunities that I had to be with non-Jewish friends. I do remember, that we used to have in primary school, We used to have Religionsstunde, which meant that a candidate for the rabbinate, who was studying for the rabbinate, would come to the various schools for release time instruction, you know, 1 hour a week. And he would do with us the Bob Abe book, you know, to how to read Hebrew. Ours was a drab book. I would sit next to a Catholic kid who had a beautiful catechism, which was illustrated, where there was an old man and a young man and a pigeon over their head, and that was the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost. And I saw all kinds of beautiful illustrations there, and ours was just doing bo ba be. So I had catechism envy of the Catholic kids. There were a couple of them who were very few in the whole class. There was one or two Protestants, and they were known as the Evangelischen. And they had a special church, which I couldn't understand at that time.
Describe the school that you went to. Was it a public school, or what was the nature of it?
Up to grade four, it was a public school. From grade four on, I went to gymnasium. Gymnasium was sort of the middle school. there was a chief rabbi of Vienna by the name of Dr. Rabina Chayes, and it was after him that school was named, because it represented a kind of liberal arts college preparation. Instead of having Greek and Latin as you would have in most of them, it was Hebrew and Latin that we got. And that was just very interesting. Many of the people were Zionists in that school. And alas, our class was not co-ed. I remember I had a crush on a girl who one day said she needed a Haggadah. It was before Pesach, and they were preparing for Pesach. And I didn't know how to express my crush to her, but I knew on every page of the Haggadah that they would be rehearsing and singing. And I put in a little note, ich liebe dich, you know. She never gave it back to me, the Haggadah. She sent it through somebody else. I must have freaked her out. And to my great chagrin, I saw her go out with another boy later on and not with me. I was heartbroken.
What language did you study in?
German was the language of instruction. In the afternoon, I went to a yeshiva. That was a different story. The teachers there were very strict and orthodox, and teaching us Talmud and Chumash and all those things. And I also had an additional tutor who helped me with the Talmud work. And some of it was quite exciting, getting into the arguments and finding out who was right, and some of the things that they came to conclusions of I didn't think were quite fair, you know. And that's how I was involved.
Do you recall a favorite Rebbe or Melamed?
I didn't have any favorite rabbis or melamed. My favorites were the teachers in gymnasium. maybe Reb Kalish. He was nice. He was a gentle person. But one of them was angry about the fact that I wore my hair too long for an Orthodox boy, and took a knife to cut it, to sort of disfigure my hair, so I would have to get the short haircut. I didn't like him at all. I was going to go and take him to the police, you know. Last minute, I was caught by somebody who saw me walking up and down in front of the police station and said, what are you doing here? I say, ich gehe den Hornstein anzeigen. I'm going to go and lodge a complaint against him for doing that. Finally, he got me to relent and even made me apologize to him, which I thought was really wrong. I didn't didn't really have someone who inspired me at that time.
How did you reconcile the two approaches?
Wait, that comes a little later. Yeah. In the meantime, I had a fantastic crush on my male chemistry teacher. So much so that I wanted to grow up and be a chemist. I would read ahead, you know, and read in other chemistry books what's going on, and I would say, could I do this and this experiment in front of the class? And I did them, and I felt very proud. So his name was Löwy, and when Hitler came, he was gone the next day. He had been a socialist, and he knew that for him there was no future there. He had to get away. And I remembered at that time that he left for Prague. I was heartbroken that I couldn't even say goodbye to him, because I really liked him a lot. And he would explain things to me after class if I would stay around and ask him. Yeah, that was a kind of, I wished that I had a teacher like that on the side that was doing the Hebrew. A contrary story. I'm still in the first four grades. I must have been the third grade. And Rosenfeld was the name of the teacher. We had a class up in the Polnischen Temple, which was a synagogue that had that afternoon Hebrew school. And every day you would go. Once a week there was another teacher by the name of Rutsky, who taught us modern Hebrew. He brought a ball into the classroom, would toss the ball. And so we would have to say, mine, yours, you know, and all go the declensions of that. But the other one was sort of a pretty dour guy. And one day he was going with this melody, na 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 na, and I go and make fun sitting there in the back, nya 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 nya, and so he says, "Bubale, come al here." He called me up, and whack on my face, and on the other side, and made me sit on his lap, and then starts to cry. And he says, do you know that your great-grandfather and my great-grandfather went to be burnt at the stake for the sake of that melody? And you're making fun of it, you know? I tell you, it made a great impression on me that he would also cry over that. But I didn't like him, no. He wasn't the kind of person that one would like. But he still made an impact on me.
Was there someone in Jewish history who served as a model for you during your childhood?
Well, you couldn't expect anyone not to like Theodor Herzl. Seeing a person, if ever you've seen with his majestic beard, you know, founder of Zionism, with this faraway look into the future, how they did an idealized painting of him. So he was a hero. And I remember a slogan that was on the Brit Bilo walls, that was the Zionist youth group I belonged to. His quote, "Wir wollen von Judenjungen junge Juden machen." We want to take Jewish kids and turn them into young Jews. You know, but this was a nice pun in German and came out really strong. And yes, he was that kind of a person. For a while, I even thought of Trumpeldor and Jabotinsky as being good models, because they were sort of the Jewish fascists at that time, and they were training to be able to stand up, that if the Nazis would come, we would have a self-defense group. There was another one was doing Haganah, so we already heard these words, Haganah, which means defense, shielding, and Betar. And I remember the excitement about saying, "Pluga, don't!" kadima tzaot, smol yemin, smol yemin. How to march and to get all those commands in Hebrew. Yeah, it was interesting.
Were you in a youth training program?
Well, we did. We weren't so much, you know, our group wasn't that much interested in the in doing that. But I would always look at those who did that with a certain kind of envy too. We were more into talking about the Zionist, socialist Zionist dream and dancing horror. That was early afternoon on Shabbos. Late afternoon on Shabbos, I went to Agudas Yisrael, to the Pirche, which was a whole other story.
Describe it.
Well, I would go to dance a horror and my tzitzis would come out of my shirt, you know, and then they would make fun of me for having tzitzis on. And I would come to the Agudas Yisrael, to the Pirche afterwards, still wearing sometimes my blue shirt from the from Brit Bilu, and then they would make fun of me on the other side. So it was a very hard thing. Sometimes I would get home in between and change so that I would pass easier.
Was there someone in secular history that served as a model for you during your childhood?
Louis Pasteur, for instance, was somebody like that. I liked the people who were the scientists, you know. Later on, coming to the United States, there was a book by Paul de Kruijf, The Microbe Hunters. but that was already later. And earlier, I felt great excitement about the people who made scientific discoveries. So, yes, Louis Pasteur was one of them.
Besides parents, who were the most influential people during your childhood, and why were they important to you?
The youth leaders in both settings, both in the Aguda. There was one by the name of Sheik at the Aguda, whom I liked a lot, they were a lot friendlier. They made space for us and for our values, and they would use our values and our experience to explain things to us. So when somebody could use Fussball to explain something about Talmud, that was wonderful, you know. Or this remarkable story about the Stefan Eshter Rebbe, who comes in seeing his Hasidim playing checkers on Hanukkah, and they're a little bit ashamed that he caught them playing checkers. He says, Shasha, don't worry. It's all right. Checkers is a good game. You can only go ahead in checkers. And if you make it all the way to the other end, you can go wherever you want. So you see, there was like, aha, aha, aha. The insight coming as a result of that. Who else? There was a guy who ran a youth theater, Uncle Nachum, and I skipped Cheder to go to the youth theater to play in one of his plays. I was found out later on by my father, who met the teacher and said, and the teacher said, I haven't seen your son in Cheder for a while, and that went patch patch. What were you doing? But I insisted that I stay until the play is over. Which was another few days, but this was very important to me to play in that play.
Was there a childhood song or lullaby someone sang to you?
I'm sorry, I'm laughing at this thing. This is so funny. When my mother wanted to punish me, she would sing me the song about the faithless son who left for overseas and didn't even say Kaddish for the mother. Mein Kind, mein Treist, die Furst weg, aweg über Jam in Größe. You're going to America, you're going very far away. And so from time to time sent Abrihivale Dermamen, sonst du mein Liebkind nicht versammeln. Please don't miss out sending me a letter from time to time. He doesn't send her a letter. And then comes finally the last letter that she ever wrote to him, which reaches him and says, don't forget to say Kaddish for me. So this would get me sad, so sad. And she would sing that when I had done something that displeased her, to show that I would be just like that kid who never wrote to his mother and had to be told to say the Kaddish when it was too late. That's a song I remember. The Friday night table songs, I remember and sing them to this day on Friday night. And Papa Olof HaSholem, you know, there was a whole routine of how to sing the Zmiris at the Shabbos table, Friday night, Shabbos at the noon meal. These were good melodies.
Can you sing one for me?
Sure. Kol me kadesh vi ye 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 kruvi loy kol shema shabbos kodesh kados me chal loy zechu choy harbe mered al pipa uvu loy ye 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 shal machne ye ye ve ye ye shal dig loy. And we would all sing along with that. And then there were some happy ones too. Yai dai 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 da da dai ya da 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 da. So when I later on went to a recording studio, I did a tape that I call the Chaim, which has many of those melodies from before the Holocaust on it. Because they are forgotten. What people remember these days is like mostly yeshiva rock. I need time out. Okay? Can you stop for a moment? No? All right, I wanted to get a tissue and one of those blankets. I'm getting a little cold here. It makes me sniffly. You gonna cut all this out or leave it in? Gonna stay in, Gesundheit, let it stay in. Okay, thank you. Thank you. Interesting memories evoke all kinds of feelings along with it, and I felt cold for a while going into that. Ah, excuse me. Okay, part of it. Okay.
How did your family identify religiously?
Papa wanted to be on the edge of the Hasidic community, not deep in the center of it, on the edge. He wanted to have access to it. So he had joined the shtibel of the Chevr Kadisha. Chevr Kadisha is a holy brotherhood, the people who take care of those who have died, wash the bodies, and prepare them for burial. Now, Papa, being a Kohen, could not participate in that work. So he did some bookkeeping, he did some other work for them so that he could share in the mitzvah that he couldn't have being a Kohen. for a while, Papa even was the gabbai of the first minyan, which meant the people who came. Most people came about 10 o'clock Shabbos morning. They wanted to sleep in, and they had the later minyan, which lasted from 10 to about 2, from 10 to about 12:30. Papa was there at 8 o'clock, often took me along with him. And the reward was that after the davening, there was always a good kiddush. And instead of doing, they couldn't do the kiddush in the shul there because the next group was just coming in. So there was a hotel was known as Barshak's Hotel, where you could go and order things on Shabbos, and during the week somebody would come and collect for what you have used up. And just like they did in the shul, they had a set of alphabetic tabs that they would put together with a rubber band, together with a money amount. So if you pledged $5 for the shul, a shilling. So they would have S-C-H-A-C-H-T-E-R, 5, you know. And then it would say shul, sometimes for rabbi, sometimes for chazan, for whoever you would schnodder. That's what it was called, making that donation. Barshak had the same setup there too. So the waiter wouldn't write anything down on Shabbos. But you'd go to Barshak, you'd take your name, and you put your name together with a rubber band, and then the waiter would put in whatever it was that you had, and so after Shabbos they would come collect. So there would be cholent and kishke and all those goodies there, and then Mama would complain that Papa already had pre-eaten when she had worked so hard to prepare the food for Shabbos that she knew that he liked, but Papa said, I can eat more.
Did your family follow any particular Hasidic rabbi?
Whenever a Hasidic rebbe came to, of the Belzer group, came to Vienna was the court of the last resort, so that the Rochester, Minnesota Mayo Clinic for Eastern Europe, so people would come to see the doctors there. So Papa took me along to some of the rebbes that came, but he himself, all the years that we were in Vienna, never went to Belz to spend time with his rebbe. He considered himself more a chosid of the father of the Belzer, whom he had met in before when he was a child, and then later on during the World War years, and when he met him in Hungary. So he was on the outs of that. He didn't belong to the Agudas Yisrael. He didn't belong to the Mizrahi. And I found myself that wherever I belonged, it didn't please him, because it wasn't quite what he wanted. But what he wanted wasn't available either. So there I was on the outs with that. Mother was not interested in those years in any what I would say, holy politics. On the other hand, let me go back to Papa, Olof HaShalom. When Purim came, he would go around and collect money, because Purim has a rule that says, Kol HaPoshit Yad Nosnim Lo. You stretch out a hand, you deserve to be given something. And Ein Botkin LeMezonos, you never ask questions on Purim. So that was always the occasion when Papa would pick a family or a two for whom he would go around collect. And people knew that Shlomo Schachter, you know, is one who goes collecting for other people. And so they never refused him. And once Papa came, was about to go up to one guy who saw Papa coming and knew that it would cost him something. So he started to shuckle and like going into davening. So Papa crept up behind him and said to him, and the people of Sodom, they were wicked and they were bad, but to God they were very much. He was twisting the sentence to say that they justified their stinginess by getting pious all of a sudden. So Papa could also give a good needle when that was necessary. Another time I remember, it was Shabbos morning. This was already about a year or two before Hitler took over Austria, that there was a Yidele who had lived in Germany, who had made his way across from Germany to Austria. And they were about to arrest, they had arrested him, and we're going to send him back to Germany. And he was afraid for his life if he would be sent back. So that Shabbos morning, there was a phone call. And they had this kind of arrangement that they usually don't answer the phone on Shabbos, but when a certain kind of number of rings would come, that meant emergency. So Papa picked up the phone, and they said, Shlomi, we need you in shul, and don't forget to bring your wallet. So that meant, you know, high emergency. So Papa went down, and they bailed the guy out until the extradition thing should have taken place, and they saved him and sent him away. I don't know where they sent him away to, but they managed to send him away and save his life. So there was this kind of an arrangement. There were people really, there was a belonging that didn't go according to party lines.
Who did your father go to for Pesach Din or Halachic decisions?
There were a number of Rabbonim. There was the Altstädter Rov, I remember, was one of them. And it was interesting. Once there was a chicken with a question, and Mama said, she'll go and ask the question. Papa said, I'll go. She says, let me go. And she dressed herself very poor and so on, so that she should look like a nebuch, and came to ask the question because she figured that poor people would get a more lenient response. I don't remember what happened, but I just remember the incident where she decided that it was her turn to go.
We'll continue on the next tape.
Okay.
Tape 3, Rabbi Zalman Schacter-Shalomi. Do you recall a particular ritual or custom that your father or grandfather did that we no longer see today?
No. You see, if I had grown up in the shtetl, it would be a different story. I grew up in a cosmopolitan city, even though this was the ghetto. It was the ghetto of Vienna. It was a time when Papa Freud was around in Vienna, and all that stuff. So it didn't have the sense that there were some things like, imagine they describe that in the shtetl, before the high holidays, there would be a shul klopper going and knocking on the various gates and says, wake up and to serve the Creator, you know? None of that stuff happened for me. And whatever did happen there is even more emphasized here. It's interesting how there were very few people who wore beards in Vienna. If they did, they were the Hasidim with the outfit and so on and so forth. But there were older people, and you already had a sense that those who wore the beards and that outfit, somehow that was the dignity of their office. And if you were a layperson and so on, so most of the people were shaved. Remember, even here in the United States, it didn't happen until the late 50s that people grew beards. The only beards that you could find here were the House of David, the baseball players, no, and the Hasidim, and they weren't as numerous as they are today. So I don't recall anything that's of that kind of a special thing. Papa would take me on Sunday mornings to the Schwitz, or take me to mikveh before Shabbos sometimes. So these were things, but these are the same things that people do here now too.
You mentioned earlier that your father took you with him to go to the Rebbe. Did the Rebbe speak to you personally as a child?
Yeah, this was de rigueur. Was lernst du? You know, what are you studying? And then you had to display what you knew. And sometimes they were kind, and they stopped just before you didn't know anymore, and sometimes they were not so kind, and they took you over the border where they could manifest, no, next time you'll know more, you know?
Did you read Hasidic literature?
Remember, when I left Vienna, I was 14 years old, 14 and a half years old. The answer is I did, but that was sort of For instance, I read a little booklet by my Rebbe, the late Lubavitcher Rebbe, that was translated into German. The stories of Buber and Chaim Bloch, who had written a book, I even have it in my library now, called Priester der Liebe, Priests of Love, Hasidic Tales, that Bin Gurion, Micha Berdichevsky, had written a series that was known as Der Born Judas, meaning out of the wellsprings of Judah. And so, of course, I read some of these things. I read some of the Peretz stories. But what really turned me on in reading was Karl May. Karl May was sort of the big adventure story. George Fenimore Cooper, and he had written some 60 volumes in German, some of which were located in America, you know, in the Wild West, and some others that were in the Near East, traveling among the Arabs and so on. And he would, in the middle of the adventure stories, have some things to say about spiritual things. He didn't like Jews very much. I couldn't forgive him that. But other than that, there's one book I remember was called Am Jenseits, At the Edge of the Beyond, where he had this a blind seer describe what's happening in the afterlife. It was just wonderful stuff. I like that.
Describe the observance of Jewish ritual and law in your home.
There were two levels. There was one level in which Bobby Chashe was doing these things, and there was another level in which Papa was doing it. Papa wanted to, he was always interested in science. He wanted to become an engineer at one point. He liked, along with the spiritual stuff, he liked to also have the scientific explanations of things. One day, Papa left me in charge of my younger siblings on Shabbos. They had to go to a particular bar mitzvah or something like that. And so I was babysitting at that time. I wasn't more than 8 years old, but I already had seen some adventure movies and stuff like that too. So when Papa came home, he found me with a chopping knife, with a cleaver in the hand and with a broom in the other, standing next to the oven and in a puddle because I had peed in my pants. So what's going on? I said, Bubby had told me that you mustn't touch the stove, the oven, on Shabbos because there was a snake curled up inside and the snake would bite you if you opened the stove on Shabbos. What she wanted me to do is observe not to touch the stove on Shabbos. I had to go and pee, so I was afraid to leave my siblings alone with the snake being inside the oven. So I opened the oven, waiting for the snake to come with the cleaver in one hand and with the broom in the other, and I was going to take the broom, put it over the head of the snake and chop off his head and then go pee, but the snake never came out. So Papa saw me this way. He made me change quick, cleaned me up, and took me by the hand and grabbed me and took me down the street in a fury until he came to Omama's house, to grandmother's house. And they were sitting at the table having their Shabbos meal together, and Papa storms into the room and says, "Zug him dem emes!" Tell him the truth, you know? So she says, "Was der emes? Was hab ich ihm getan? Hab ich gekundet, ich habe gesagt, was willst du für mich?" He says, "Is there a snake in the stove or there's not a snake in the stove?" You know? And he didn't let off until she admitted that she had told me a lie in the service of wanting my observance better. And he says, you hear? He says to me, you hear? Don't believe such stuff anymore. There is no snake in the stove. Come home. Well, he was so brave, so angry at this. And I'm glad this was a wonderful experience to debunk. So Papa, that Papa could get into a fury. He was a Kohen. That was part of his, a Beza Kohen. When he got into his fury, it was strong.
What was your favorite Jewish holiday as a child?
I liked all of them. Simchas Torah was always fun. Purim, so-so. You know, I would get dressed up several times. I would borrow from the women who were working for us, babysitting and so on, borrow some dresses and high heels, and I'd walk down and be, you know, and got whistled at, you know. And that was fun, a little wig on. But that wasn't the happy fun. It was sort of you had to compete with the other people who were dressed. You had to make a little spiel, hind this Purim morgen is ois, and you had to go so what's your shtick today? You know, and you had to do your shtick. So I had my shticks there. Some of them were these skits that almost everybody had about the guy who's in front of the judge who says to him, what is your name? And he says, Leiser. You know, and say, give him the Yiddish name, but it also in German means speak softer. What is your name? And the last name is Lauter, which means louder. So, you know, so you had all these curious, fun things to do. That was Purim. But Simchas Torah I liked.
Describe it.
Well, the dancing was always wonderful, but one Simchas Torah, they decided to give the people who get called to the Torah funny hats. And so everybody had to wear a funny hat when they got called to the Torah. They called Papa to the Torah, and they gave him a funny hat, which was this kind of German army with a pointed thing there, and in front of it they had a string, and on the string was an egg that had been blown out but filled with plaster of Paris, so it was pretty heavy, and on the string, and it was so that if you would chuckle in the davin, it would bang you in the nose. So they put this on Papa's head and called him to the Torah, and Papa goes, Baruch Hu Es Hashem Baruch, and hitting the people to both sides. And I still remember that with joy.
Do you recall a particular Passover?
They didn't stand out at that time. We didn't have many guests for Passover. You know, the family was together. Parents worked very hard. One thing I do remember on Passover that impressed me a lot, the woman who was sort of the servant person who took care of the family and the dishes and stuff like that, on Passover she was asked to sit in a place of honor. She wasn't to serve on that day, as a sign that we went out of Egypt and we were freed, and that was very impressive. Each one of us would get the job of serving her plate.
How was Lag BaOmer celebrated in your community?
Outings. We would go for an outing. Most of them would be a football game, a good football game. For fun, we would sometimes make bows and arrows and try and shoot at a target. Nothing that special for Lag BaOmer.
Who made your first pair of tefillin?
Who made mine? Papa was, about tefillin, Papa Olav HaShalom had a very strong sense. He wanted me to have a very good pair. So he bought a pair of tefillin, and then that was his job for all the grandchildren, you know? And that's become my job now, too, for to provide the children, the grandchildren, with a pair of tefillin. So he went to a sofer who had imported them from Tisminitz in Poland, which were a pretty good pair of tefillin, yes.
When was your bar mitzvah?
It was Parshat Ekev in Veslau, which was a summer resort where we went to, and in that little shul there. That summer resort was close to a place called Baden by Wien, which was a sulfur bath. The chief rabbi of Baden was Rabbi Naftali Karlebach. Once I was sent in with a chicken to check whether it was kosher or not, and I met Shlomo and Elichaim Karlebach there, and that was our first encounter. We played a little football there, and that's when I first met him. So yes, this was so in Veslau, I did my portion of the Torah reading and the Haftorah, and I davened Musaf, and that was just wonderful. I gave a little speech that my bar mitzvah teacher had written for me. Nothing that I would remember very much today.
What charitable organizations or societies were your parents involved in?
Well, they were not, it wasn't organized the same way that there is this. But when somebody needed a free loan, you know, that Papa would give such loans, Mama would give such loans. They belonged, the Chevra Kadisha had a free loan society. It was, but they would always go around collecting. This is interesting because to her very end, my mother was in charge of these private acts of charity that in her neighborhood in Los Angeles, people would bring her money and she would distribute that because they trusted her that she would know whom to give it. And people who need it would also come to her. And so it was always like you never knew who gave and who took. Was remarkable. You know, so my mom didn't belong to an official organization about these things, but one point I met a woman, a violinist in Los Angeles, who described to me how she went shopping in the supermarket and met my mother, who was having a little wagon there that was also her support. Like a walker, and did the shopping, and got involved in conversation with her, and in such a warm way that this woman, who was pretty far from Judaism, embraced Judaism because my mother sort of gently reeled her in to that. So they didn't belong to official groups, but I think they did a lot. Papa, and when we were in camp later on, undertook to be leader at the Davenin, and was cook, because some of our people did not want to eat from the kitchen of the camp that provided some tray for food. So Papa would cook the rice and peas and stuff like that, and that was his job that he undertook to do.
How would you describe the relationship between Jews and non-Jews in your community?
In Vienna?
Yes.
Vienna was really curious about that. there were moments when you had a sense that people got along very well, and another moment you had a sense that we would get stabbed. The Viennese In some ways, were even more rabid anti-Semitic than people in Germany. I remember when the plebiscite was in Austria and Germany about whether they endorsed the National Socialist Party. In Germany, they got 92%, and in Austria, they got 98%, the Nazis, which was really strange. But they turned so fast. Just even before Hitler came, they had prepared the flags and everything else. It was very, very clear that they would turn on us. And just as I told you about Hans before, you know, you couldn't count on loyalties.
Did you have any other incidents of anti-Semitism?
It's so hard to describe. One of the things that I tried to learn, and this is already after the Anschluss, yes? It was clear that if you wanted to survive after emigrating from Austria, you needed to have a kind of work that you could do. So my parents had been doing the textile stuff, and so I couldn't find anything with chemistry, so I went into learning how to weave. While I was working at the loom, I got my appendicitis start to act up. And so I couldn't stay there for the rest of the day. The pain was very severe. So I took the trolley car to get home, but I couldn't stand up, and I wanted to sit. But just as in a Jim Crow thing, you know, there were some people who didn't allow me to sit. And so I was standing next to the conductor, you know, holding myself and bent over with pain. Finally got home, and Papa took me to the doctor, who rushed me right away to the hospital, and they did an appendectomy. 2 days later was Kristallnacht. And they brought some people into the hospital who had been, one of them had been stabbed by a bayonet over and over. And the doctors had just tried to put him together. He was still under anesthetic and the ether at that time. A Gestapo man came in and claimed that they were hiding a Bolshevik there. They didn't want him to survive. He says, I want to see that he was really wounded, you know. They opened him up, and the guy bled to death in the ward. So it was a difficult experience to have, that there was no, you know, even after having injured a person, and in the middle of a big hospital ward, there must have been about 40 beds in that room when they invaded that in the middle, and there were people who were recovering from all kinds of sicknesses and surgery. Yes, it was a difficult time.
Were you aware of Hitler's Mein Kampf?
You know, the propaganda was very strong. What he had said in Mein Kampf didn't touch me as much as what the propaganda was. The propaganda was that he is going to build Autobahnstraßen, that he was going to bring technology in, that he would have a Schienenzeppelin, meaning a sort of a bullet train from Berlin to Hamburg in 2 hours, that he would have even the Autobahnstraßen would be lined with Hagebutten, what's it called? Rose hips. So that vitamin C, that Germany would be freed from having to import vitamin C if they needed, they should have enough. Ships that were luxury ships were offered to people for vacation, Kraft durch Freude. There was a sense of, you know, that I felt sad that Hitler was against us, because I thought that he was, if he would let us work with him, it would be so wonderful. The British could not be relied on, because the Balfour Declaration they did not hold, and they did not allow us to go to the homeland. So we had hoped that if Hitler would only be our friend, as it were, and then give us Palestine so that we could really go and settle there, that this was good. I even saw some money that was being prepared for a Jewish enclave in Poland at that time for resettlement of Jews, and there was no word yet around that this was for extermination. So there were these, in a sense, for an Austrian, it was a hero. That here came a person who would reverse the ravages of the Versailles Treaty, in which Germany was so terribly oppressed, and so on and so forth. I mean, that's the sense I had. Kids that I saw, rowdy urchins-like, now dressed in decent uniforms, marching and playing the flutes as they marched in a marching band. So I looked, Hitler Youth was looked really good. I wish we would have had a Jewish branch of Hitler Youth. So it was this was the ambivalence at that time. I wasn't that much aware we knew that there were some people who were at Dachau, who had been taken to the camp there, and who came back as ashes to families. About that we knew.
How old were you when you first felt the effects of the war on anti-Jewish measures?
Oh, it was clear. Even before Hitler came, there weren't any measures there, but the discrimination was not too subtle, even in Dollfuss, Austria. But it certainly was clear that when Hitler came, that at the Anschluss, that we had to get out of the way of the people who were marching down the street, that it was that the brown shirts had power. At one point, some Hitler Youth guys took me and a friend of mine, Felsenberg was his name, Moshe Felsenberg, took us down near the Danube and beat us up. They started to cut the payas of Moshe Felsenberg. And I could have kicked them into the Danube. I was in such fury. I didn't dare, because on the other side, a guy was playing with his Luger, watching the whole business, and we didn't dare to hurt them, because then it would mean our families would get it. So after being beaten up and left there for a while, we could crawl home. That was still alive. That felt good.
How did your daily life change?
We moved very quickly to a kind of paranoia. Watch out. Make yourself not as visible. Hide out. I remember something. Papa had a gun, it was there if he ever would need to defend the family. He had hidden it in the closet. After the Anschluss, he made me take that gun and dispose of it in a garbage can, not in our courtyard, because one wasn't permitted to have any arms at home, and so that would have been a terrible thing to find in our home. If they would have found it, it would have meant a dire thing.
How old were you at this time?
14, 14 and a half.
We'll continue on the next.
Okay.
Tape 4, Rabbi Zalman Schacter-Shalomi. Can you describe in detail how your daily life was affected?
Summer. I would go to the Freibad. This was in the park. They had a pool for kids, and I would go and mingle with all the other kids, and it was not a problem. When Hitler came, that was off. We would go and hang out in various parks, and felt it was okay to go you didn't have to be going in big groups, because if you went with a friend, you didn't expect to get beaten up. That changed.
When did that change?
Right after the Anschluss.
And the date?
We are now in March 1938. The moments of the Anschluss, that was, you know, just to go back, this was a very... We never listened to the radio on Shabbos. So you can imagine, this is Friday evening, and Shushnik is going to give the last... gives a talk. It was the last talk that he gave, in which he announced that the German army was crossing the border. He had gotten a guarantee from Mussolini that he would not allow this, and Mussolini had sold him out. And he was saying goodbye to the Austrian public. And his last words were, Rot, Weiß, Rot, bis in den Tod. The Austrian colors, red, white, and red, until death. And and the next voice you heard was already taking over for the Nazis coming in. And the next morning when we went to synagogue, on Shabbos morning, we were so surprised to see the Nazi flags hanging on houses, and people wearing, even the police, wearing Nazi armbands, which we couldn't understand. I mean, how quickly could they prepare this overnight? So you had the sense that this takeover was already planned. We felt very insecure walking through the streets from that moment on. All of us contracted in May scarlet fever. And was a question, who is going to be inside with us and who will be outside. So Papa took over the inside care for us, and Mama was doing the shopping and brought things until the scarlet fever was over. It was amazing how we felt secure, because there was this quarantine sign on our door. I had just come back from the hospital. This was already in November. After that Kristallnacht occurrence, when about 2-3 in the morning, it was about 2:30 in the morning, we heard the heavy boots in the hallway. And it's amazing how light we slept, that another time we would not have been so ready to wake up, but we heard those boots coming. And we knew that they were stopping at our door, banging, open up, im Namen des Gesetzes, in the name of the law, open up. Two policemen there, asking my father to show them his passport, seeing it was a Polish passport that was lapsed. They asked him to get dressed, and they arrested him. What was happening all over Vienna at that time, that, you see, the Viennese police, it was already a police state before the Nazis came. So if you were in... if you were going to spend more than 24 hours in any domicile, you had to write a Meldezettel. The police had to know who you are and where you were. And they had that in every district. So they knew who were the people who were Polish citizens and so on and so forth. So they came and picked them all up for deportation. So here I was, and we were all shaking, you know, seeing the police there. And this was not, these were not brown shirts, these were not SS people. But to see that the police was also getting very gruff, and they were supposed to be sort of our protectors. Papa had a watch that he liked a lot. So he gave me this watch and said, "You are now the man of the family. I hope that I will see you again." And with a tearful goodbye, and neighbors stood behind their closed doors, you know, hearing, knowing all that was going on, and nobody stirred or said anything, and they took Papa away. We were on tenterhooks trying to find out what was happening at that time to him, and we heard some amazing stories about the cantor Frankel. He was the cantor in whose choir I sang as a choir boy. Was trotted out in front of all the people who were in that compound waiting to be deported. And the person in charge, who was a Gestapo officer, asked him to sing. And he sang the song, "Eli, Eli, Lama Azaftani, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" To all the people who were there. You can imagine how they all burst into tears hearing the cantor sing that. They were put on the train and sent to the border of Poland, to Zbungin. Papa didn't have any money with him. You know, there wasn't anything. The food that they were given was just some bread and water during the time. When Papa came to the border of Poland and he saw the Polish soldiers behind the machine gun, they now again they had to show their lapsed Polish passports, and of course they got abused by the soldiers for having not been good Polish citizens, allowing the Polish passport to lapse, and so on and so forth. So Papa saw this and he snuck back into a train that was crossing the border from Poland into Germany and hid in that train until he got to Breslau, and then called us on the phone, and we wired him some money so he should be able to come back to Vienna. Being scared at the same time, he was deported, what right has he got to be in Vienna? Nobody could offer him more than one night because of the Meldet settle, otherwise he would have to tell the police that he's there. They would have noticed that he has returned. So it was very clear that we couldn't stay. So the word was that if you came to, I'm just telling you about how this, there were rumors every once in a while that for 24 hours the Dutch border would be open. So we went to Emmerich, to the Dutch border, and then we were not permitted to come in. We were sent back to Vienna again. All during this time, my parents could no longer run the store by themselves. The Nazis had a way of putting in a commissar, which was they took somebody who was unemployed and set him up as being the boss over the people, and so any income that came in, he would skim off, and that was his take-home pay. So you were under scrutiny. You couldn't do very much either about organizing your escape or something like that. So all had to be done in the great secrecy. Let me go back a little bit. Going through the summer, and we would meet from time to time at grandmother's house and look at various atlases. There was a song around at that time, "Wohin kann ich gehen, als verspart von mir ist er jede Tier." Where can I go to? Every door is locked for me. Jokes were around, the gallows humor jokes. One went like this. Guy comes to a travel agent and says, "Can you sell me a ticket to some place?" He spins the globe and he says, "Maybe to Paraguay, you know." And he says to him, do you have a taufschein, baptismal certificate? He says, no, I'm Jewish. So he spins the globe further and looks for British Guiana, here, there. Says, sorry, there isn't a place on this globe where I can sell you a ticket to. So the man says to him, maybe you got another globe, you know? So you can understand the bitterness of that, the sadness. The Nazis were taunting us, seeing us in the street. They would say, sind Sie Arier oder lernen Sie Englisch? Are you an Aryan or do you learn English? Because it was very clear, where would you want to go to a country where English is spoken, either to England or to Canada or to the United States and so on.
Were you still in school at this time?
School was over for me by June 1938. It didn't make any sense anymore to think of school, regular school. What made sense is, what kind of a work could I learn? So that's when I started to go to the weaving school, learning how to do that. So here we were in... We had been brought back from, come back from Holland, where they did not admit us. And the second time we felt Papa could not stay. So Papa and my brother and Uncle Yankele, and he was the one who married my mother's youngest sister, Peppy, and several other people took a train to Cologne. We had heard that in Cologne there was a cafe where you could meet smugglers. And we knew we couldn't cross the border legitimately. So the price was 1,000 mark per head to take us across. They wanted the money in advance. So they got the money in advance and told us to cross a particular border point. The German border police let us through, making sure we didn't have more than 10 mark on us. And we crossed, and we were waiting there for the smugglers to come, and the smuggler doesn't show. And the smuggler doesn't show, and the smuggler doesn't show, and you can imagine the chagrin. We had given him that money. There's no recourse that we had to get that money back, and there we were stranded, and coming back we had been warned that that was a no-go. Finally, another man came across that path, hung with some laikas that he was smuggling into Belgium. And so, whether he was appointed by the smugglers whom we bought, or whether he wanted to do some extra business on the side, we had to give him each our 10 marks for the privilege of walking with him. He took us across what was then known as the Dragon's Teeth of the Siegfried Line. And here I was just 3-4 weeks after the appendix operation and really hurt. And we had a green blanket with us. And at one time, we were told that the Belgian border police had a sweeping searchlight going across. So we had to run so many steps and then get down on the ground and cover ourselves with that green blanket. So many steps. So that for a while, while we were in the range of that, there were some dogs that were barking, and we were very scared that we would be caught by the Belgian police and sent back to the German border police, who would then and we had the sense that then you get shipped to Dachau, you know, if you come back. It was a harrowing night. We made it across. He took us across to the Belgian border.
When was this?
This was in November, December already, 1938. And as we are crossing the border, on the other side was the Maginot Line. And the smuggler knew already, he says, be careful, there are mines over here. So we had to avoid the mines and duck every once in a while. We made it across, was a 6-7 hour walk, and we came to Eupen Malmedy on the Belgian side.
Who was with you?
It was Papa, my brother, Uncle Yankele, Tante Pepe, and their little boy, who at one point started to cry. Uncle Yankele was carrying him, and he had to put his hand over his mouth so he shouldn't cry. And we were afraid that the child would be choked to death from not being able to breathe and cry. So you can imagine how upsetting it was. There were 3-4 more people with us, whom we had met in Cologne, who were also Jews from Burgenland, a section of Austria from which they had expelled Jews to and sent them to Vienna. We get to the other side, and we are told, get into this garage and hide behind. There were a couple of taxis in the garage. So we hide behind the taxis. once again, covered with that, while the smuggler went inside the house to talk to the taxi drivers to take us to Antwerp. So they wanted to get paid for taking us to Antwerp, and by this time we didn't have anything. We could get it to them because we had some relatives in Holland at that time. And would then pay him back, but he wanted to have some. Anyway, first there were some Belgian gendarmes who shined in some flashlights. Luckily, they didn't see us. We went into the farmhouse, and there talked to the taxi drivers, who said that they wouldn't take us. Just it was dangerous for them, and so on and so forth. They wouldn't take us unless we paid. And we said, we haven't got anything to pay. So every one of us took off whatever we had of jewelry, gold, and so on and so forth, and gave it to them. They looked at it under a magnifying glass and said, it's 14 karat gold. In Belgium, we only go with 18 karat gold. So you can imagine how we begged them. At one point, I got so exasperated, there was a picture of Jesus, Mary, and Joseph up there. They were Catholics. And I said, how will you be able to look them in the face if you don't take us? The old woman, the mother, was sitting on the side and was praying all along, and she said to the sons, take them. So we took all our rings and everything and wrapped them into a kerchief, gave it to them, and made a rendezvous point where we would give them the money and they would give us back our jewelry in Antwerp. And then they took us to Antwerp, and we arrived there just about a little bit before dawn. Papa went out to look for some food because we hadn't had anything to eat all during that time. And there was this Jewish bakery open because they had taken us to the Jewish district. And a policeman came by. They had an outfit that looked like the British bobbies. He started to interrogate us because he had seen the license plates that they were from the border, and so they didn't have any reason to be in Antwerp at that time. So Uncle Yankele pleaded with the policeman, please don't send us back. And the policeman's heart opened up. It was so amazing. He said to us, well, you can't go around without having some kind of identification. And so you go to such and such a place in City Hall, and they're going to give you some temporary identification. Since I didn't have anything with my picture, an ID, they took the picture. They took a picture, and they put it on this ID card, and then wrote the so genaamde the Zalman Schachter, which was a way of saying the one who calls himself, you know, because I didn't have any documentation that I was that. And they gave us temporary stay cards, and we got settled with other refugees who had come over. Then in Belgium, we started to make arrangements for Mama and for Bubba and Zayde to come over, and for my two sisters to come with Mama. And they arrived on a Shabbos, again, with such a cab, and we took care of all these things in it. There's a rule that when, for some reason, you have to break the Shabbos and you arrive into a place, the place where you get off, you can't move from until Shabbos is over. So the house where we were staying at that time, we stayed there until Shabbos was over, and then we tried to find lodgings. And so we had found some lodgings in Antwerp, and that's where we stayed until the time they started to bomb Belgium.
I'd like to go back a little bit. What did you do with your family assets when you left Vienna, and your belongings, your Jewish articles and that kind of thing?
Whatever we could carry, like the talis and tefillin and a sitter, we took that along. Mama started to send us stuff from that she could send through the mail, and we had to go to the duty officers to pay our import duties, and they let the material in. But we didn't take that much. The silverware we took, that stand there for that's for the candelabra, still comes from Vienna. It had a very fancy thing that went on top, but somehow that was lost. Under the eyes of the commissar, they couldn't send very much. We had an arrangement, I think, with the Joint Distribution Committee that went something like this. They needed money for the people who were destitute in Vienna. So we gave them the money, and they gave us dollar assets in the United States. So we were able to get together $1,500. Now, at that time, that was a considerable amount of money. Other people got more together, but it was impossible to get more out of the business by that time. We couldn't sell the business to anyone, and the commissar was there, and all this was fraught with danger. They had an arrangement at that time that if you wanted to get a $10 bill, you had to give 11 singles. And if you wanted to get a $100 bill, you had to give 11 tens. The notion was that this is the way you can hide it better. Larger denominations, you could hide them better. And people would wrap their money rolls into condoms and wear them inside their body. This was just the way in which you could take money out, and it was always dangerous.
Describe your daily life in Antwerp.
At first, when we arrived in Antwerp, I wanted to continue going to school. So I signed up to a school for electricians. I figured here, you see, every time it was a very concrete thing that we needed to do. Papa was at that time studying how to be a shochet in the family tradition, because some relatives in Canada, in Newcastle, New Brunswick, they could get him a visa as a shochet, and they had sent him a contract that was he would get so much for chicken, so much for calf, and so on. And he was working away on the knives to try and get rabbinic okay for serving as a shochet. And he got that together. I worked for a while in the in that school, and expressed myself quite well in Dutch by that time, in Flemish really, and but then when school was out in the first summer of 1939, I didn't want to go back there to the trade school. Instead, somebody else who had come from Żółkiew, Joshka Shapiro, who had his fur business, took me in as an apprentice. So at first I would sit and work with little snippets of Persian lamb and sew them together into plates so that they would, out of the plates, they would then make whole coats. And it was very tiny work working on the. Then I learned how to do Persian paws to match them and to sew them and to learn that whole business. Until that wonderful summer of 1939, when I found myself so angry at God, at Judaism, at the world, that I wanted to have a fight with somebody about these big things. So I figured I'll go to Agudas Yisrael Shabbos afternoon, and there they would be studying Pirkei Avot, the ethics of the fathers, and the statement begins, all of Israel has a part in the world to come. Oy, am I going to give it. So then I come into that place, and indeed they're about to sit down to study that part. And I stand near the door for a quick getaway. And soon after he begins to, this man who sits at the head of the table, begins to teach, all of Israel has a part in the world to come. I say, pie in the sky in the sweet by and by, all crazy stuff. Nobody ever came back from there, you know. And I let out with everything else. You guys say that when the Mashiach comes, we'll all be equal. Yeah, then we'll be on top and they'll be on the bottom. And I started to make fun of the whole business. The kids who were sitting around the table were ready to tear me apart. And I was so glad that I had this opportunity of fighting. But the guy at the head of the table says, shh, calm them down. He says, what else? And I kept on pouring out all this poison. And then he says to me, would you like to hear from somebody who agrees with you? By this time, he had me. So he said, does someone go upstairs and bring me down such and such a volume of the Talmud? He brings him the volume of the Talmud, and there is Maimonides' time, I think. We are getting close, yeah?
We'll continue on the next tape.
Okay. Of
take
course.
Take five, Rabbi Zalman Schacter-Shalomi. Please continue.
Of course I wanted to know from someone who agrees with me. But I couldn't believe that this would be in our tradition. So when they brought down this volume of the Talmud, Sanhedrin, and the back of it was Maimonides' commentary on the Mishnah, dealing with precisely this thing. And Maimonides says, there are lots of people in the world who have all kinds of opinion as to what happened to a person in the afterlife. And he says, they're all grossly misunderstanding what this is really all about. And there are five different categories of people who say, some people say it's going to be in this world, it's going to be like a big rock candy mountain was going to be like. Others say the dead are going to crawl out from the graves. Other people say that trees are going to grow baked bread and clothes already, and that the rivers are going to be full of wine. All this is very silly stuff. Then he goes on to say, how could a blind man talk about color, or a deaf man about music, or a eunuch about sex? So most people don't know spirituality either. And then he proceeds to talk about the 13 principles of the faith and what the afterlife is like in such a pure way. By that time I was taken, but more even I was taken by that person who let me say what I needed to say, and I walked him home. After a while, I found out that he was one of the people who were studying the Tanya, the work of Reb Shneur Zalman of Ladi, which was a Chabad teaching. So they were somehow related to what we know now as Chabad Lubavitch. Where did they pick it up? So I was curious because they were Galiciana. They didn't come from that area from White Russia where the Chabad people come from. And I found out that they had studied at a yeshiva in Heide outside of Antwerp. And the man who was in charge of teaching them the spirituality of things and to help them out with the Talmud was not a professional Torah scholar, but he was a diamanteur, you know, someone dealing in diamonds, who spent 2 weeks, two days of the week at the diamond club doing his business and the rest of the time at the yeshiva in Heide. And he would choose special students who were interested in learning deeper and teach him the Tanya too. Other people made fun of him because his name was Moshe Chekhoval, and they would say, "Ha, you're learning the Torah of Moshe, ha-ha," and make fun of that. But he was a remarkable person, also clean-shaven. I would come to his house sometimes to daven, and it was a wonderful surprise. That person, Boch Merzel, and God bless him, he is now in Jerusalem in a home for the aged there. He had been to Auschwitz, and thank God he made it out. A remarkable soul. I have here two of his Hebrew books that he had written, teachings on the Torah. Beautiful stuff. So he and his cronies had an atelier where they were working on diamonds. And diamond cutting is a very noisy work because one diamond cuts rubs against the other diamond. It makes a lot of noise. They were sitting around the table, often singing at the top of their voices Hasidic melodies while they're working on the diamonds. And at other times, one guy would sit with a mic, and they had earphones on, and teach some Talmud. And if they had a question, they would sort of shut off the machines, give a signal, and discuss the question, and go on. And instead of working 8 hours, they worked 10 hours, but it was yeshiva and work together. So you can imagine how much I wanted to learn from them. So I learned from them both the physical and the spiritual, and that was a remarkable learning. It took a while. They didn't want to initiate me yet into Tanya. They felt I wasn't quite ready. One Shabbos afternoon, when they were meeting to study Tanya, I locked myself into the bathroom so I could I could listen in what they were doing. They discovered me, and they let me have it. I wasn't yet ready for the initiation. Can you imagine how I was on tiptoe? Oh, how I want this. For my birthday, they gave me a copy of the Tanya, but they said, "This is your copy, but you are not going to get taught until we consider you to be ready."
How old were you at this time?
16. Yeah, the longing for learning that was very great. One point I was sitting and reading to myself of the Tanya, and one of the guys came by and shut the book on me, like saying, "That's not yet for you." I was so heartbroken. So I was waiting for Boruch Merzel to come, and he went for a walk with me and consoled me and said that all this longing that I have for the learning is going to pay off. Wait until you're ready. And that's when I got the book as my present to keep it until, so you know, we are not going to dismiss it just so. You'll learn it, but it's not yet time. Well, here it is April 1940, I had learned to do some of the fur stuff, I'd learned to do some of the diamond stuff, and our affidavit finally had come in, and we were going to the American embassy asking for, when we get the visa, you need a passport for a visa, but we didn't have a passport. So we were sent to Brussels, to one of the offices there, to get what they called a Nansen passport. It was something that the League of Nations had created for people who were stateless, who had no affiliation of citizenship. So we got those passports, took them to the American embassy on Thursday, and the visa were waiting, and on Friday we were supposed to go and pick up the visa. We had our interviews, we had given the money for the stamps of the visa, and so on. That Friday morning, the bombardment starts in Antwerp, and at this point, we line up with many other people in front of the American embassy, and they don't let us in. And a man comes out and says, they have strict orders from Washington until the international situation clears, no visa ought to be handed out. So there, we couldn't get our passports back. We didn't have our visa. And in the meantime, by Saturday, Sunday, streams of refugees start coming in because a blitz had started. And there was a question of whether they're going to flood the dikes or something like this to make... to keep the Nazis from advancing. They didn't do that. And on Monday, most of the Jews fled Antwerp, and they went to the French border at La Panne. We couldn't afford to flee yet at that time.
What were you doing to make a living during that time in Belgium?
We were receiving dole at that point, refugees. I didn't make much money from the work that I did. I was apprenticing.
How were you treated as refugees?
The Jewish community had, the Joint Distribution Committee had a kitchen, a soup kitchen. We went to the soup kitchen. They gave us a little stipend for rent. They were very good to us, and we all had a sense that the Hayas and the Joint Distribution Committee is going to help us in our transition.
Were you aware of what was happening to European Jewry during this time?
Well, it was Poland was only invaded the fall before that, in the fall of 39. So, yes, we got news of things, but it wasn't yet so dire, because the ghetto was still there in Warsaw and in many places. We had heard some rumors about Auschwitz, but nothing was that much confirmed at that time. But it was, Papa Oliver Sholem had said, while yet in Vienna, to my uncle Akiva, said to him, Kiva, don't go back to Poland. Stay with us. We have to go west. Kiva said, no, I want to go back. I don't feel safe here. I want to go back to Auschwitz. And if you care for me, you'll advance me the money, so I should be able to go. And Papa said to him, please, please, come with me. And Kiva said no. And so Papa helped him with the money. And he was one of the first, Akiva and his wife and three of my cousins were one of the first that were taken. My brother has managed to get some pictures of them, because he's working for Yad Vashem Institute, and he has some of this material. He also found out about so many more of the people in our family, and I would hope that if there is a branch of this work in Israel, that they videotape him too, because he has so much of this material that he can offer. So here we were... it was Monday, and we still lined up in front of the American embassy, and we figured maybe we'll get the visa now. No. We tried Tuesday morning. No. and it was clear that we couldn't stay in Antwerp. If we wanted to get away, we had to leave. We took a train going sort of in the other direction, but you couldn't get out directly from Antwerp. So we went to Brussels, Anderlecht, and there was a train waiting there to go into France. That was not a passenger train. It was a coal train. You know, they had these big wagons open to the sky, steel wagons, and we loaded up. And the engineer with his family also there, all to leave. The train took off and must have had about 60 wagons hitched up to it and made its way to the French border, where it came to a town called Mons, Bergen. Just as we came there, the Stukas, the airplane Sturzkampfflüge, called the dive bombers, and start to strafe and bomb with something like napalm the station. So the whole thing that would normally happen at a border with the border guard checking papers and so on and so forth, that couldn't happen. But we also couldn't go through the station because the station was collapsing and burning at that time. So some people had gotten off the train and were switching rails, and he had to just move the train very slowly through behind through all the industrial places until he could get it hooked up again to the main thing, which was now inside of France. And there were two set of tracks. One was going south into France, and the other one was going north. The track that was going north was filled with French soldiers, and often there were colonials too, Senegalese French soldiers, on a flat car. And at one point, they had killed a horse on that flat car. We saw them drive in the other direction to start cooking for the soldiers, to have some food for the soldiers. Everything was in disarray. The French had not anticipated that they would be beaten so badly. Again, German planes came and strafed the train. At one point, we had to stop, get out, and hid under the train so that the bullets wouldn't get us. And one napalm bomb fell into the last car. Luckily, we were able to get the people out from there, but the wind was coming from the back and the heat was coming at us. And one guy was held by two people, by his legs, to uncouple the car in the back while we were going south. I still feel the stress of that moment. I remember looking out over the landscape and seeing here and there explosions. How I was both excited and frightened. Excited that when Papa had told me about the First World War, and I figured, will I ever see a war? You know, now I was seeing a real war. And so looking at all these things, and then going through the night, through a whole night into France. And we wanted to ask the engineer to let us off in Paris. You know, Jews want to be left off in Paris. There was no way he would do it or that he could. Now we were, you know, on a train you can't steer. You go wherever they sent the train. So the train went farther south than Paris, and we were sort of disheartened that we couldn't get to Paris. We didn't figure Paris would ever be taken over by the Germans. This was our good fortune, because the train didn't stop until we got into the Département Allier, where Vichy was. And just a little bit north of the Department of Allier was that line of demarcation where occupied and unoccupied France was. So we were now in unoccupied France. But we didn't know that yet. The battles were still raging. They let us off in a town near Montluçon, and that's when we were first quartered at a farmer's place. So I started to ask people how to say this and that in French. My first words were, j'ai faim, I'm hungry. Je ne peux pas manger la viande de cochon. J'ai mal à l'estomac. I can't eat pork because I have trouble with my stomach, you know. So I should be able to avoid that. And so that farmer was very good to us. And I remember the Shabbos that we did, how glad we were that we were able to relax. What I had taken on my shoulders to carry along in this flight was the family silver. All the silverware and everything else, because we figured there may be a time when a spoon sold will save us. So on the next, after Shabbos, there was manpower was very, was not available. All the men were at war. So there was a need in a factory there, a tar factory, for some unskilled labor. So I went there. With a bike. I biked back by Wednesday or something. I biked back, had only done 2 days of work in that factory when there was a black Mariah waiting already from the Sûreté that picked up my father, my mother, my grandfather, grandmother, my brother, sisters, and they were waiting for me to come home. And they took me too, and they took us up to that camp. That camp was at Chateau Fremont. This was a very rich castle, which a Jew by the name of Stavisky had owned at one point. There was a whole scandal about money with him, and we were assigned to the stables of that place. And so that's where we stayed now for the next 3 months.
I'd like to go back a minute. Would you go into more detail about that Shabbos that you had, the restful one before this happened?
Well, there was the bread was a French baguette. We had some olives there, a can of sardines, and we shared this all around. And my grandfather, he was a step-grandfather. He had married my grandmother, who was a widow from my real grandfather. He was a Vizhnitsa chassid. His name was Reb Yisroel Eltis. He had this nice way about him that he would eat a piece of bread and says, "This is the fish." You know, we're eating fish. We would then, in our imagination, eat all the wonderful Shabbos food, which was another piece of bread and another olive. In our imagination, and we sang the songs and everything else that we would do usually on Shabbos.
Thank you. Please continue with when you got to the camp.
So, the commander of the camp had been a high school principal. I wish I could remember his name. I blotted it out in my memory. He was a nasty character. He would go with a Jodhpur riding boots and have a whip, a steel whip in his hand and a gun when he came into our compound and barked orders and so on. And he had us go and work. And he there was this field there. I enjoyed going to cut down trees and making firewood. That was easy. Chopping wood was a delight for me because it always called on ingenuity. Will I hit it just right, and will I avoid the knot hole, and so on. But he took us out into that field and said, this field can't be worked. There are too many rocks here. Dig them up. So we set to digging up those rocks, and they were not easy to move around. So we had to wedge them and get to roll and really put a lot of energy behind them. We got the rocks off the field. And then we figured we flattened the ground out. Now we're going to go and plant something. And, you know, that was our notion. We'll plant some potatoes. We'll plant some onions. So we will be able to do something with our diet, which was pretty sparse in the camp. I remember sneaking up to the officer's kitchen and taking the coffee grounds that they were throwing out and recooking them again to make some coffee in a can. You know, in an old can, a little fire, so that that we would get some coffee, because they didn't give us coffee.
What were the facilities like there?
Where
you slept and
we slept in the stables. In the stable, they put some straw on the floor of the stable, and there was was Papa and Mama and the four siblings. We took Susie's stable, which wasn't very very large, just enough for one horse. There were other barns and stables there, and lots of people were kept there. One morning, we were told that it was after the surrender of France and the unoccupied, and the Nazis were on the other side. We were told that the Gestapo was going to make a inspection of our camp. That night, three people committed suicide. They did not want to be found alive and being sent back. They had a sense that the Nazis would not let them live. Some of them were socialists and that, so you can imagine what that's like to find these three people hanging on ropes and neckties and so on, with the faces blue, the tongues swollen. And the Nazis came in. We were all sick with dysentery and stuff, so you can imagine that the latrines were in a lousy shape. Latrines was a ditch with two boards, and you had to stand, crouch on those boards to do your thing. And there was blood and feces on the floor, and sometimes they would put some lime on there to disinfect it. The Nazis came and they looked at the bodies of the three men who had committed suicide, and then came around, and it was interesting to see how the French officers looked like lackeys in front of the Nazis with their military hats that they had on, and they kicked into that latrine and said, if you want to kill those Jews, kill them, but do it sanitarily, you know? And so they had kerosene poured over them and set a fire, and we had to go and dig new latrines according to their specifications. So it was unoccupied France, but never mind. They still had a strong call on what was happening there. The day France surrendered, there was an old rabbi there who had served as a rov in Żółkiew, not as a rebbe, as a rov. And he was leading a service, a memorial service for the French soldiers who had fallen and for the surrender of France, and we were all in tears. Every day there was appel, which meant that we had to line up, and they called out our names, and if you weren't there, it was trouble. So when he had set up that, we had cleared that field, we're thinking now we're going to go and plant something. One day he came in and said, "Who gave you permission to remove these stones? I want it to be put back as it was." At that point, it was so, the work was so aggravating. Every joy that you might have in doing, achieving something was taken away, because it was very clear. This guy gave us tasks simply to, you know, to wear us out. And so I had one of those pickaxes. And I hit one of those rocks with it. Last thing I saw was a spark coming out from there, and I fell down in a faint. Papa was not permitted to bring me any water. Finally, a dog licked my face, and I woke up and dragged myself back. Had terrible migraines after that, from this trauma of this thing, because it's like the bridge in Tokori, you know, you don't want to do this work this way. It was very aggravating.
We'll continue on the next tape.
Okay.
Tape 6, Rabbi Zalman Schacter-Shalomi. Were there any other prisoners there besides Jews at this camp that you were in?
Not that I can recall. That was so crazy, because excuse they gave for putting us into the camp was that we had come out of Austria or Germany, so that they were expecting us to be spies, you know. But it's made so really no sense whatsoever that we would be spies. But this was a way of saying they didn't want us around on the countryside or in the cities, for that matter.
Who was in charge of discipline in this camp?
That lieutenant, the camp commander.
Who was of what origin?
French.
Were there other people who worked with him, or he?
Yes, there were other French soldiers who were fraternizing with us. They were really friendly. Sometimes sneaking an extra piece of, you know, whenever I would come up there for duty to wash dishes at the officer's kitchen, they would give me some extra goodies, some extra food to take along.
What kind of clothing did you wear there?
Just what we had. Sometimes we had, when we worked in the field, we got some rough work clothes.
Did you receive any mail from anyone or parcels from anyone during that time?
No. We were, everything was in such turmoil that the Jewish community hadn't even gotten back to its own emergency thing. In the second camp, we had a visitor from the Joint Distribution Committee. I'll tell you more about that.
Okay, why don't you go ahead from where you were?
So at any rate, after a while, there was a commission that came to camp, and those of us who claimed that we were waiting for visa, we didn't want to stay in France, were released from the camp, given vouchers for the train, and that was a giveaway. If we would have gotten bought regular tickets, we would have been in much better shape. But we didn't buy the tickets. We took those vouchers, and when we arrived in Marseille with those vouchers, the gendarmes there took us aside, didn't let us get into town, and took us off to the next camp. That camp was located on a river, I think it's the Arl River, that was near Carcassonne, where there is that Roman aqueduct. And we could see it from the camp where we were. On our side of the barbed wire were, again, Jews who had escaped and come in refugees. And on the other side were refugees from the Spanish Civil War. And they had been there now a number of years. They were treated even harsher than we were. And it was during that time that Papa Olav HaShalom started to become the cook for us, so that we would have our own food. In the meantime, someone came from Joint Distribution Committee to visit us, and we asked him, "High holidays are coming, could you at least send us one prayer book so that we could work off that?" He was a very nice man, the one who came, and then we all, whoever had anything to do with a possibility for an exit, for a visa or something like that, gave him the details, and he became our ombudsman. So at one point I had snuck out of the camp to, I was on a work detail with somebody and snuck out of the camp and got hold of it, came to the butcher early in the morning. The butcher asked me whether I wanted some meat. He understood that we were on camp. I said, "No, I don't want any meat, but the corner, I want a horn, either of a sheep or of a goat." So he gave me a couple of horns. They still had the bone inside, and it was before Rosh Hashanah, so I wanted to make a shofar. I have that little shofar over there that I made there. Of course, I didn't have tools, so I cooked. First had to cook out the bone from the two horns, and then taking a piece of wire and sharpening it on a rock, I made like a drill and worked on it and worked on it and worked on it. One of them, the drill broke through, and the shofar was not, could not be used, but the second one worked. And so here is Rosh Hashanah, and we are meeting the daven, and everybody tries to remember what they knew by heart. The machzor didn't come. We got up very early because we had to go for work detail afterwards, so we wanted to get the Rosh Hashanah davenin together very early. There were some older people who said, "I want to blow the shofar," and I said, "No, I made it myself. I was bar mitzvah, you know, it's my shofar, I'm going to blow." So came the time to blow the shofar, I blew the shofar, and the commander walked in, wanted to know what was that noise about. So I said, "Monsieur le commandant, c'est le cornet de notre libération." he said, how amazing, yeah, how crazy this is, and pulls out a list and starts reading us the list. Before he reads the list, he said, "Blow it again, tootle it again." So I blew the shofar again, and all the people gathered around. He started to read off names of people who would be released from the camp, whose visa were waiting, and our name was among them.
I want to go back one moment. The first camp, what were the dates that you were in the first camp?
It was from late April to about late June, and by July they...
Of what year?
Of 1940. By July they let us out of there, and right after that they took us up to that other place near the Aral River, that factory.
So when this list was being written, read, what date was that approximately?
It was September 1940.
Thank you.
We made some interesting connections with some of the people who were the Spanish refugees, who were on the other side of the fence. We would often talk with them and learn some of the songs of that they sang in the battle. So this time we are. There's a question: should we leave on Rosh Hashanah because we're ready to go, or should we wait another day? Some people said, "Don't wait; he might change his mind." And some people said, "No, if God has given us this thing, let's finish Rosh Hashanah." We stayed there until Rosh Hashanah was over. Then went to Marseille, and we're Yom Kippur in Marseille.
How did you get to Marseille?
Train to Marseille. This time we bought tickets, and they didn't stop us.
How did you keep track? You talked about Rosh Hashanah. How did you keep track of the Jewish calendar at that time?
Somehow we managed. somehow we managed. Maybe somebody had a little calendar with him or something like this. We did manage.
Did you do any other Jewish rituals in either of the
camps? Oh, we davened all the time. We met for Shabbos morning early during the day when we would go on work detail. Those people who had tefillin would share with each other. This was part of the routine.
Were there any other religious articles there?
No Torah. None of that. We didn't have enough Sidurim, a little Siddur, but not the High Holiday Prayer Book.
Were you aware of what was happening outside the camp during this time?
Not much. Because we were really isolated in the camp. No radio, nothing of that. But when we got to Marseille, the first thing is we checked in with the Jewish community. And there was a soup kitchen on Rue de Convalescent. Upstairs was a soup kitchen. Downstairs was a little synagogue. That was the shtiebel where we met. Papa began to teach the kids some Hebrew school. And I remember a woman came and said, I want my child to learn Hebrew, but none of this religious stuff. So Papa said, well, what about if something, isn't it good to have some food to eat? She says, yes. So, no, what do you object? I'm going to teach him to say Hamotzi Lechem in Aris. By the time Papa was saying to her, she had agreed that he could teach the child, but he needed to teach the child. But we were going around, you know, not having much to do. And there were other boys of my age, and we became friends. I would go for long walks, and found out that on the Vieux Port there were some fish markets that were throwing away the fish heads and fins and stuff like that. So I would go and collect them, and Mama would cook them up, and we would eat what we could. And fish heads were were wonderful food for us at that time. I'd go to the Vieux Port. I think it was the Count of Monte Cristo had been there in prison and so on. And I would dream about traveling and check out. At that time, Syria was under French colonial rule. Is there any boat that's going to Syria? Because I figured we'll go to Israel from there. The visa were still slow in coming. Luckily, the American embassy was able to get the visa and the passports that we had left in Belgium to us in Marseille. So, after having my grandparents were shipped off to Canada first, because they already had Uncle Yankele was there in Canada from earlier. He had gone yet from Belgium. So they went as farmers. Farmers. He kept on asking him questions, and he didn't know the answer. How does a rooster fertilize the chicken, and so on and so forth. What did he know? Oichmar, a farmer, but he was going to go and be a farmer. That meant you got a Canadian visa, and you had to stay on the farm for at least 5 years. So they went via Portugal, and they got out. We were still waiting for a visa. One Shabbos afternoon, I go for a long walk and go to the Sephardic synagogue that was a beautiful building in Marseille, and come back to our shtiebel, and there's a man sitting there with a pork pie black hat and is teaching. And that stuff that he's teaching sounded to me like what I'd learned from the people in Antwerp before. Later on, they tell me his name is Rabbi Schneerson, Schneer Zalman Schneerson. So I said to him, after Shabbos is over, may I walk you home from the hotel? So we go along, and I ask him whether he could fix us up somehow with someone to teach us, because we could, you know, we had so much free time on our hands, if we could have a yeshiva. And he set us up with somebody who had studied that at Yeshiva in Heide, and who was several years ahead of us and could teach us to become our teacher. I had seen a person there who impressed me a lot. He had a beard, did not wear the black hat and black outfit, long coat, and I heard him speak in impeccable French and study with a Moroccan Sephardi Chacham. And so, you know, this, I thought that he was a Moroccan too. He was a real nice, noble bearing, so I kept on wondering who he was and had fantasies about him. When Reb Zalman Schneerson said, on Tu B'Shvat, New Year of the Trees, I will not be able to be with you. I'll be in Vichy. I have some business to attend to. So I'll send you a guest. So we sat down at the table with some schnapps and some fruit to celebrate Tu B'Shvat. And in comes the guy I thought was the Moroccan. And he sits down. I'm sitting at the side of the table. He sits down there at the head of the table, close to me, and begins to talk to us in Yiddish. What are you studying? And we told him we were studying the tractate of Ketubot. And he began to explain what we were studying about, when a man should marry a virgin, when should a man marry a widow, which day of the week and which day should he marry a divorcee if he marries. And he takes this whole business into history. And here it is, when will God redeem the Jewish people? Will it be like a virgin? Will it be like a widow? Will it be like a divorcee? And lays it all out in such an amazing way that I see history unfolding this way. And finally he gets to say, but we were neither like the virgin in relation to God, nor were we like the widow who hadn't done anything wrong. It's not her fault. We were very much like the divorcee. We had sinned and so on. But a divorcee is to be married on Friday. And it's already Friday afternoon in those 6,000 years. When will the redemption be? And he began to cough, which was his covering up, weeping. I was so touched by what he had to say. Still didn't know who he was. He gave another talk, then wished us well and went his way. Our visa had come through, and then came our passage on a boat. It was the Ipanema that took us from Marseille to Alicante, to Oran, Algiers, Casablanca, Dakar, Martinique, and finally to the Virgin Islands, where we got off.
How long did this journey take?
Oh, about 6-7 weeks. And what we ate during that time was bread and sardines. I must have, I got to like sardines because it wasn't anything else that we would get. And we would, Papa would always make sure, ask for a lemon so that we shouldn't get sick from that, because we didn't eat whatever else was being served.
And what was the date of this travel?
It was somewhere between beginning of February to April.
Of what year?
1941. So it was wonderful when we came to the Virgin Islands. After going through immigration procedures and all that stuff, we were so happy to be there. Now, the first thing is you want to start looking for Jews. We find out there's a synagogue there. So we see a store open that says, Hanna Christensen Levine. So we come in and say, possible Mr. Levine to speak with him. And she says something like, honey, Mr. Levine's been dead for a number of years. I'm Hanna Christensen Levine. So I say, are you Jewish? She says, yes. Black lady. All right. So we ask her about the synagogue, she tells us where the synagogue is. We walk down the street some more and see a store, David Sasso. I said, Papa, this is a Sephardic name. Let's go and talk to him. So we go inside. Turns out he was the lay rabbi of that community. Sasso, Sassoon, it's that family. And he invites us to come Friday night. Papa wasn't so sure he wanted to go and daven with those people who were sort of reformish or something. But he was curious enough. So we davened at home and then went to the service. Turns out Hannah Christensen Levine and a beautiful contralto singing Lecha Dodi in that synagogue. And there's sand on the floor and there's a little organ in there and so on. So that was our adventure. Pesach is coming closer and closer and we still can't get to the United States. We take a boat, the Alcoa Steamship Company, over to Puerto Rico. In Puerto Rico, we start looking for matzahs. They tell us you can have one box of matzahs because the rest of the matzahs are needed for the seder because the bishop is going to come, the USO seder for the soldiers. Finally, Papa was ready that we would have the six matzahs that were in the box, and the rest of it we would eat pineapples and bananas for Pesach. We go down to a park while my parents are looking for passage. Maybe we can get no passage available. My little sister Ada has to go pee. I'm in that park and we don't know what to do. So I see it's a place information. So I take my brother and my two sisters and go to the information place and say to the man, is there, sir, I'm looking for WC, water closet. Oh, the little one has to go wee wee, he says to me. And he points to the bathroom and she goes to the bathroom there. And he starts asking us all kinds of questions. Mr. Richardson was his name. Who had retired from the army and was serving at that point as the information officer. Here's our story, goes to his safe, opens the safe. In the safe, he had another little safe, takes out three cigars, sticks them in his pocket, and says, come. And so he takes my hand, I take my brother's hand, sister's hand, so we trail after him. He goes up to the Alcoa Steamship Company at this point, walks right into the vice president's office, and everybody says, hey, Frank. Hi, Frank. They greet him. They know him. And he goes in. He says, I need six passengers to be out on the next boat. And he says, we haven't got the berths for them. He says, you're going to fix them up. We're going to stay in your office until you find them places. And each one of us got a couch in one of the cabins that was there, and we got on the ship and got the day before Pesach arrived in the United States. We're met by Uncle Abe, and that's another story, taken to the Hayas, and there we stayed for Pesach. On the seventh day of Pesach, I decided that I wanted to walk to Brooklyn. If you know 8th Street, on 3rd Avenue and Bowery in Manhattan, to walk all the way to Eastern Parkway, you know. And I started to walk because I wanted to go to Lubavitcher Rebbe. So I asked this policeman, how do I go to Kingston Avenue? So he says, what number Eastern Parkway do you want to go? I say, 770. He says, du wirst gehen zum Lubavitcher Rebbe? This is a cop, Brooklyn cop. And shows me the direction. I start walking. And I gave up two blocks away from Eastern Parkway and started to walk back to the Hayas. The next week I went to see the Lubavitcher Rebbe and claimed that I have regards from his son-in-law, because indeed that man who was the Moroccan was Reb Menachem Mendel Schneerson, who was the next Lubavitcher Rebbe. So when the secretary of the Rebbe asked me, so What will you bring the Rebbe? I said, regards from his son-in-law. So he let me in to see him, and the Rebbe asked me to repeat what he had said. A couple of times he made like this, like I didn't do it so accurately. And then afterwards, in 5 minutes, had our family settled. He had my story out, the important things of my story. My brother in the yeshiva, my two sisters at Shalamit school, a contract for fur for our family, all that settled in a very short time, and this is how we settled in Brooklyn. Our apartment was on the third floor. The second floor was a women's gallery of a shul, and the ground floor was a shul, and we set up a fur business up there. In one of the rooms, and that's where we lived for a number of years, on 53rd Street and 13th Avenue in Borough Park. Okay.
What was the date that you arrived in the United States?
I don't remember. Just the day before Pesach. You know, I could go and look it up if necessary, but we didn't count it that way. Still in the Hayas. I want to go and see my friend who had studied with me with that group in Belgium, and he had arrived in the United States early and was already studying at Lubavitcher Yeshiva. So I want to go and see him. My uncle Abe tells me how to go to visit my friend. So he tells me in plain Yiddish, and this is the plain Yiddish story. Wes gehen er op downstairs, a door gehen doch in Lobby, es gehen across the street, es to sehen die entrance from the subway, es gehen reinwarfen an Nickel and Turnstile, es gehen downstairs, es to warten auf ein Local, dann noch müsste changen von einem Express, und zunächst ist er a subway, dann noch ein Wert von einem Elevator, und es darauf gehen auf 33rd Street, auf 55th Street, 13th Avenue, dort in der Utrecht Avenue Station, es gehen machen a left turn, es dann noch müsste sehen zwei Blocks, dort wohnt dein Boyfriend. And I was supposed to understand this in plain Yiddish, and I'm not supposed to know the English. That's how it hit me, that what American Yiddish had become, spiked full of English words.
Were you aware at this time of what was happening in Europe?
Now we got to be aware, yes. The Morgen Journal, Papa got the Morgen Journal, and we listened to WEVD. The war was going on during that time. WEVD, the station that speaks your language. And so there was always a Yiddish commentator of the news by the name of Herschel Levine. I hadn't thought about that name for years, you know. And Herschel Levine would say, give us the news. He would say, 20,000 Jiden dabei umgekommen in Bialystok. 20,000 Jews were killed in Bialystok. He had a whole thing, Herschel Levine, a penny an aeroplane. For each airplane that crashed, he collected a penny and gave it to the war effort. All his Yiddish speakers who were listening sent in that money for that thing. Around that time, I was already at the yeshiva at that time, the vice president was Wallace, and the president was Roosevelt. And 1,000 rabbis, having heard all that which was happening in Europe, took a Sefer Torah and went to Washington on a march and wanted to see Roosevelt and to ask him to do something, to bomb the ovens, to do something. And Roosevelt didn't come out to meet them, sent out Henry Wallace to meet them and said there was nothing that could be done. You can imagine the upset that this had at that time. If people say we didn't know, I think we're closing our eyes to it. You can get back copies of the Jewish Chronicle from London and see the statistics of the people who were killed. So it's not. I remember even picking up a Reader's Digest in which Arthur Koestler had written about transports of people that went to the camps and how they were singing the song, What Will Be When the Mashiach Will Come.
We'll continue on the next tape.
Okay.
Tape 7, Rabbi Zalman Schacter-Shalomi. You mentioned that you were already in yeshiva at this time. What were your aspirations and goals?
I wasn't at that point interested in becoming a rabbi. My interest was to learn as much as I could about how I understood to be the innermost part of the Torah. The rules and regulations, yes, they were important to me, but more important was how does one get close to God? And how does one learn to daven? Because that was something that everybody told you, you ought to, but they never told you really how. And what I saw most of the time is that people were into reciting. And, okay, so you recite. And when you recite, you learn how to recite very fast. So then pretty soon, davening meant like to rush through it fast. That's not what I saw when I came, not from my people in Belgium before. And I had a sense that there is deeper communion possible in davening. So I watched the people who were teaching that. That was the yeshiva where you could learn about that.
What was the name of the yeshiva?
Lubavitcher Yeshiva in New York. And so I sought out the people who would initiate me into these things. And that was part and parcel of what you learned in Lubavitch. So we had to be at the desk for study 7:30 in the morning, which meant getting up at 6 to go to mikveh, to prepare yourself, and so on. We studied from 7:30 to 9, and the stuff we studied always was the spiritual stuff in the morning. From 9 to 10:30 was time for davening and for breakfast. So sometimes I would skip breakfast because the davening was exciting, and I stayed with that. I'd found nooks and crannies where I could go and meditate so not to be disturbed. And I was lucky at that time. I was put in charge of opening and closing the building in the morning and at night. So that gave me an opportunity when nobody else was there to sit late at night and meditate there and so on. So those yeshiva days were very, very wonderful for me.
How old were you at this time?
Well, it was between 17 and 21.
Who was the Rosh Yeshiva?
Well, his name was Rav Mentlik, but he taught us the Gemara aspect. And while I appreciated what he was teaching, he was not the person I was looking up to. It was more Reb Shmuel Levitan and Reb Yisrael Jacobson. These were the people who were teaching us Hasidism. And Reb Yisrael Jacobson was the prayer coach. Once he saw me daven and making faces like, so he gave me a wink on the side and said, did you try already with a smile? And they said, no. And, you know, it was like a Zen whack, you know. Woke me up, and then I began to daven like this, you know, with a smile. And it was so wonderful, what I learned to transform from the Nebuch thing. These were also apropos of our issue here. It was also very important years, because in 1943, when the ghetto uprising took place, the Rebbe published 4 broadsides about in Tog and Morgen Journal. These were the 2 Yiddish papers at that time, about the coming of Mashiach. And we would go around in the street. The Rebbe said the air in this country is polluted, and he didn't mean physically. And one way of cleaning, precipitating all the dirt, was to put out, recite the Mishnah, so that the words, letters of the Torah would fly through the air and clean it up. And he said in those Kol Koiris that the walls of the exile are burning down. He lost his daughter and son-in-law, another one there, and many of the Hasidim. And it was also with great miracles that he came out from there, vacating some buildings where people were saying, let's go and hide in the cellar. And he said, not in the cellar, in the sukkah. And the sukkah was spared and the cellar was bombed and people, stuff of this sort. There were so many stories coming through at that time. I remember rabbis calling a fast day for what we were hearing. And the question, the fast day coincided with the 1,000 rabbis going to see the president. And nothing happened at that time. So these were hard days. And when I was in the yeshiva, there was a prediction that in 1943 Mashiach would come. So when 43 came to an end, Mashiach wasn't here. You can imagine the feeling. Then we started to figure maybe it meant a little later, maybe we had the calculations wrong. But the attitude was very clear. This was the end of the exile. At the same time, the Rebbe was sending out people to start yeshivas all over. In New York, they had the attitude that what is in New York is out of town. You know, so Jews were not supposed to be out of town. But there lived some Jews out of town, so none of the other movements in Judaism were interested in establishing beachheads in the out-of-town places. Lubavitch was. So I was sent out to first to Bridgeport and then to New Haven. We collected kids release time instruction and then got them into Hebrew school in the afternoon and made propaganda they should come to a day school, and we built a day school. And in that day school, we were both the drivers of the school bus and the janitors and the whole thing, and we got the school started. And today, it's a very good yeshiva going on in New Haven.
Who was your chavrusa, your study partner in yeshiva?
Avram Weingarten, the one who had come from Belgium with me. And then there were some others. It was funny when we were called by the draft board to present ourselves. One of them asked, one of the shrinks asked, what do you do for fun? Because by the time, you know, yeshiva bochum, no sex, no this, no that. No, what do you do for fun? So one of our friends said, well, you sit and study with Yisrael Gordon is full of laughs. So because he was one guy who always was jolly and very friendly and was a joy. Beit HaMidrash was a wonderful experience.
Are you still in touch with any of them?
With some of them, yes.
Did you speak about your experiences in Europe to other students?
I tell you, it's seldom that I do all that kind of retrospect. It's part of my nature to look always more toward the future. I'm interested in what's going to happen, not so much in what did happen. So some people were caught in that and had the sense that they had to go over this experience. I remember once the Kloisenburger Rebbe had just arrived in the United States, and he had been through hell, and he was leading a service, and the entire service he was pouring out his heart and was crying. At that time, it was for the mincha, and you know, it was very, very hard to hear that, and yet I so appreciated that here was someone who was doing this. Williamsburg was waking up, the Satmar Rebbe was coming, all the others, and so they were creating their enclaves. The first thing was they wanted to make sure there should be kosher meat. Glatt kosher meat was what they wanted. Lubavitch didn't have even a Lubavitch butcher store. We bought the Satmar stuff because we were more interested in setting up educational institutions. And that was a remarkable time.
Did you have personal contact with the Rebbe?
I would say frequently. Frequently meaning that at least twice a year I would go and see the Rebbe about my where I was. I would write almost every month. And once it was before Pesach, the yeshiva was behind in paying me my salary by 8 weeks, and I didn't have any resources. I wrote to the Rebbe for a blessing so I should be able to make Pesach, that some income would come. And I got back a letter, never mind the blessing, how much do you need to be able to make Pesach? And he sent in a check for $200 and said, this money is my partnership with you so that you open your house and bring in some other people for the Seder. It was just a wonderful teaching. Later on, when he died, I stayed with and Reb Menachem Mendel Schneerson became the Rebbe. I was in touch the same way and wrote him, sent him carbon copies of all the letters that had anything to do with spirituality to people so he could criticize them, you know, critique them and then send back notes. I still have them in my files.
How long were you with Lubavitch?
Basically till about 1964.
What prompted you to leave?
Well, several things had happened in between. It wasn't that I left. I just felt I graduated. You know, it was like, it was no longer the scene of my awareness. But I was working very hard at that time on my dissertation. My dissertation was dealing with the Rebbe-Chassid relationship, and it was printed in a book, Spiritual Intimacy. For me, it was like the psychoanalysis of my relationship with the Rebbe, and I began to understand things. In 1968, the break, as it were, occurred. I had, in 62, 63, gotten involved with finding out what this psychedelic experience was about. And I met Timothy Leary, and it's a long story how I met him. And he took me into that situation, which I reported then to my colleagues, other rabbis, conservative, reform, orthodox, and I shared with them what that experience was like. Once I spoke in Washington, D.C., I was invited to speak, and I offered two topics, Moses and McLuhan and Kabbalah and LSD, and they wanted both of the topics. So after I spoke on Kabbalah and LSD, another speaker came in, and she blasted me all over her paper. She had a journal, and I was working on my doctorate at Hebrew Union College, and so it came up that she called Lubavitch. She was at that point asking, did Zalman Schachter take LSD with the Rebbe's okay, because she was ready to hit the Rebbe for that. So they said, no, he did it all by himself, you know, and also his credentials are questionable. So she published that. So the president of HUC called in the board, the admissions, and said, how could you let him in if it's questionable credentials? And they said, they're very good. He's got smicha from Lubavitch, you know, and got an MA from Boston University. What's wrong with having him in here? So he said, all right, make sure that the orals are going to be very tough. And they were very tough. I got my doctorate, and when they had called Lubavitch and they had said my credentials were questionable, that hurt a lot. I sent a letter back to the Rebbe and said, if someone had called me and said, listen, we couldn't, you know, we were embarrassed by this question, we couldn't stand behind you and support you, but at least nobody called me up. Nobody told me that internally this wasn't so. So this pained me a lot. On the other hand, I also had seen past the edges, you know. When you're in an Orthodox situation, you see everything through the frame. When all of a sudden the frame moves away and you see beyond the frame, and this is what psychedelic experience had given me. So I began to appreciate other religions, other ways of dealing with consciousness, and also appreciate what I learned in Hasidism, but from a deeper perspective than I had before. So that basically meant that I had to go my way.
Did you discuss this with the Rebbe before you went your way?
Well, this was a strange thing, because even before I had my LSD experience, the Rebbe gave me some extra schnapps, 4 glasses, at once to drink down. And then he said, have a good retreat and a good meditation. So I once talked to him afterwards about it. In fact, I sent him that report that I gave to the rabbis as to what had happened to me, because I kept feeling I don't want to be opaque. It's like not to tell your doctor where you are, or your lawyer, or your Rebbe, you know, it doesn't make sense. So I would be quite open. But I felt there was a withdrawing of things that sort of, I was an embarrassment to the movement by that time.
What did you feel you were leaving behind, and what did you feel you were gaining?
Well, I tell you, there's several pivot points. Once I was in Pittsburgh speaking to a group of students, and there were some Lubavitch chevre who sat on the other side of the room watching me work, because I had a reputation that I can do this very well with the students. And I was talking to them and not to the students. Then there was a break, and then I got back to speaking, and I decided, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to talk to them. When I'm talking to the students, I got to be with the students. And I felt then, too, like something came apart at that time, that I don't want to preach to the converted, you know. I really want to be with. I felt that there were enough Orthodox people handling the Orthodox side. They didn't need me. So you want to find out about family and children and all that kind of stuff.
I also wanted to know, were you able to go back to the Lubavitcher Rebbe for guidance, or did you ever feel the need to do that in later years?
I did come back several times, you know, to say L'chaim. When I wrote him a long letter from Boulder in 1975, I felt I wanted to tell him where I was, I never got an answer. And I wrote him in English this time. I said, I don't want to write to you in Hebrew, which would sort of indicate that I'm writing like a chassid again to the Rebbe. I want to tell you who I am these days. I didn't get an answer. Then I came to Philadelphia, and I wrote again. Came, and he greeted me nicely, gave me lekach and a blessing and so on and so forth, but I felt that something had broken. About 3 years before he passed on, I went to Brooklyn, took my son Yotam, and made this pilgrimage to see him again. And again, he gave me a blessing. That's what the photograph that you have there. He gave everyone $1. He said to me, Reb Zalman, you're a Kohen. Yes, he remembered that. He says, well, when you're blessing the people as a Kohen, keep me also in mind. Then gave me another dollar bill. And it was a nice meeting. And at the same time, it was like, you know, much more distant than it had been before.
You mentioned that you got a degree from Boston University and Hebrew Union College. What kind of professional things have you done?
Well, I was interested at one point to be a therapist. I figured, you know, that I would move more into the secular realm, and because inner processes interested me a great deal, and that's why I had done some chaplaincy training and mental hospitals and so on and so forth. And then studied at Boston University, met Howard Thurman, who was a remarkable mentor of mine, and learned from him also spiritual processes. So at one point I was going to Israel, and I wanted to take a didactic analysis from Eric Neumann, who was a Jungian there, and get my PhD from Hebrew University with Gershon Scholem. That didn't materialize, so that's when I went to Hebrew Union College afterwards. And I had done pastoral psychology at Boston University, so my doctorate was in human relations. That's what I wrote that dissertation about. And pastoral, these kinds of things were of interest to me. I felt after I was in Manitoba for a while, more and more attracted to the spiritual side rather than to the psychological and psychotherapeutic thing.
So how did you go about that path professionally?
Well, I was teaching psychology of religion also at Manitoba, but then was invited to come to Temple University, where I was for nearly 12 years, teaching, no, not 12 years, it was 9 years, teaching psychology of religion with an emphasis on Jewish mysticism. So it was around, and I need to go into a whole other thing having to do with what I started doing on the spiritual side at camps, Ramah and summer camps, and how the Jewish catalog came about, and the Chavurah movement, and finally Jewish renewal. So this was a whole other part that didn't have to do so much with my professional thing, but with my vocation.
Did you get married?
Yes. Through a shatchan, my first marriage was to someone who was a teacher for Lubavitch. So it was like very much like, I'm teaching for Lubavitch, you're teaching for Lubavitch, so let's get married. But the how I proposed was, is it okay to ask the Rebbe? You see, because you don't get married without the Rebbe say so.
And what was her name?
Fagel.
And how many children did you have?
With her, I had 5.
And then were you ever married again?
Yes, I was married again afterwards. And then to Ilana.
And how many children did you have with her?
With Ilana, I had 3. Yeah. And now I'm married to Eve. Yeah.
Do you have any grandchildren?
I have 22 grandchildren. And I suppose pretty soon some great-grandchildren are going to come along.
What kind of education did your children receive?
One is a lawyer. The other one is an investment broker. And the third one is a works for Xerox Corporation fixing computers. Tina is Mimi is in Israel and is working in an office. Tina is runs a child care place in Georgia, and John is into computers too, and Lisa is working as a clerk for the university. Shalvi is studying at the Michlala in Israel. Baria is now in the high school program in Israel. And Yotam is preparing for Bar Mitzvah, which will happen in May in Israel.
Did you tell your children that you were a Holocaust survivor? And if so, at what age?
I would tell him a number of stories around that. For instance, whenever we would have Passover and would come to that the Egyptians made us work with hard labor, I would tell him the story about what happened in the camp, about somebody who gives you work to do that is just to keep you busy and to suppress you with that.
Are your grown children Hasidic?
Well, Sholem, let's put it this way. Mimi settled in Modi'in because Shlomo Karlebach founded that moshav. So she is positive in that direction. Sholem is sort of very much a modern Jewish renewal type chassid. Joseph, who was named after the Rebbe Yosef Yitzchak, is not that much interested in things, although he's a nice balabos, you know. And Yale is a very nice balabos, affiliated with a shul, not Hasidic. Shalvi, on the other hand, is planning to marry a Braslav chassid and has now become very observant and to fulfill a blessing that Lubavitchers would give each other, saying, may God bless you with children that shouldn't want to eat in your house. So when Shalvi came to visit over here, everything was checked for kosher, etc., etc.
How do you think you were affected throughout your life by the war?
some people get, when they get kicked in the rear, turn around and say, "Who kicked me?" And some people, when they get kicked in the rear, go ahead. I was very much in that second category. I just didn't feel like, you know, I would hang out sometimes with Elie Wiesel, and I don't like to drive by the rearview mirror. You know, this is this has a strong bearing on Jewish renewal too. You know, I felt first I wanted to do restoration, to see can we fix things up so it should be like before the Holocaust. That was proved useless. There are lots of people who want to do that. Let them do that. I have another vision that asks, how are we going to educate the tzaddik for the year 2050? You know, what do we need to put into that hothouse for Jewish spirituality? That's what interests me more.
What kinds of things give you pleasure now? What kinds of things give you pleasure?
The greatest pleasure I get is seeing both children and grandchildren and my students doing good things in the world. Every time I get a good report that Reb so-and-so in this town is doing something wonderful, I'm delighted. Living here in Boulder with Reb Tirtza and her congregation is a great joy for me. Less than that, Eve gives me a fantastic amount of pleasure being with her and living with her and sharing with her, processing life with her. It's wonderful. Then Naropa gives me pleasure. At this point, I'm doing a series of lectures at Naropa about paradigm shift and finding people who are interested in what I have to offer about futuring spirituality gives me great joy. More yet when my students who are out in the field come back for mentoring. 2 weeks ago, one of them was here, and it was a great joy to help him prepare for his ordination. Sometimes some people who are already ordained come and tell me what they're doing in the field, and we can start working on deepening this. These things give me a lot of pleasure.
We'll continue on the next tape. Tape 8, Rabbi Zalman Schacter-Shalomi. You shared what makes you joyful. What makes you sad?
When people make themselves for turf issues impervious of what's happening in the world. In other words, why is there not greater unity among our people? Makes me sad to see how things are going in Israel at this point, which doesn't seem to go up. It seems to be going down. There seems to be an entropy that snuck in. I wrote an article for Tikkun magazine, 50 years of Israel, its anniversary, that the dream has gone out, you know, the vision has gone out. And what is left now is a state that is moving. It's not going to have such an easy time as it had before. The first 50 years were of chesed, of grace and kindness, and they were more forgiving than the next 50 years are going to be, and getting it together is going to be an issue. What makes me sad is the short view that the corporations have, seeing it only for the quarterly bottom line instead of seeing seven generations. Makes me sad to see that in this youth culture there are so many wonderful people who are aging and who could be sages and serve the planet and serve the country in a much better way, and they are they're sort of invisible to the population. Makes me sad also to see that there's a kind of laziness that's come into a search for comfort that the Judaism that people are, even if they are embracing it and they're doing a lot more than they did in the 40s and the 50s, there was a 30s, there was like wanting to get away from it. There is now a sense that people want to affiliate stronger, and I'm happy for the affiliation. I'm not happy for the shallowness that's there, and I'd like to see something deepening. And it's also true that in some ways it is happening. The deepening is also happening. But that it isn't happening better and stronger is somehow, for me, a sadness. Yeah, that's about where it is.
How do you deal with loneliness?
Well, there's several ways. You know, one is a vertical way. So do it. How can I be lonely if God is around? The other one is, of course, being in a relationship with a woman like Eve doesn't leave much of that longing of with whom can I have a connection and be understood. Thank God, that's wonderful. I am lonely in relation to my peers. I have a sense at times that some of my peers have given up asking questions. They're too much into the answers and too much into maintaining status quo and driving by the rearview mirror. I would like to have more conversation with my peers about what is ahead. On the other hand, people who are not quite my peers, but with whom I have fellowship, like this morning when you saw this group of people that was here in the house, and we meet every Monday morning to have these wonderful conversations about spirituality of the future. I don't feel lonely. sometimes I wish I would, you know, because the telephone keeps ringing all the time, and sometimes I wish I had more solitude than, you know. Loneliness is an interpretation of being alone. And when a kid on Saturday night is alone, feels lonely. When I come home and there are no messages on the telephone machine, hamachaya, you know, I feel good. So I don't feel that loneliness is my issue.
What has been the hardest time of your life and how did you deal with it?
It's not only one hardest, you know. It's like people, I know sometimes you make it dramatic, this was the hardest time. I had hard times. I had a hard time when my congregation in New Bedford didn't want to continue my contract. And I was 18 credits away from a PhD at Boston University. And I couldn't finish there and I had to take my job elsewhere, and I was looking for another pulpit, Orthodox pulpit, and I couldn't get one. They didn't take Lubavitch rabbis at that time in out of town unless they were part of a Lubavitcher setup, and that I had to take and shave off my beard. That was a hard moment for me, and then I took on the Hillel post, and that was a transition. I've learned about those hard times. First of all, there is an element of coping that you do. And I tend to go from into a counterphobic mode, you know. Tough stuff is happening. All right, let me figure out what's the way to go do about it. I don't get into the oy vey stuff. So that's part of this forward-looking thing. So I coped. Often, in retrospect, I found out that the things that gave me a hard time were the things that propelled me to the next place where I had to be, to the point that in the eldering work, we do a exercise that I call thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies, meaning inviting all the guys that did me wrong to a banquet and say thank you because you propelled me to the next place.
Do you think about God in relation to the Holocaust?
Do I not? Sure. I wrote a long piece called Patterns of Good and Evil, dealing with the issue of what people call the theodicy. If God is good, how could there be evil? If there is evil, how could God be powerful if he allows that? So if God is good and powerful, then I can't understand as a contradiction. So I try to deal with that. Another side of dealing with the Holocaust, and that's a harder one, that's much more painful, is to say, what was our contribution? You know, most of the time we say we were victims. I know enough when I'm working with people about what it means if people want to perpetuate their victim status, declare themselves as being powerless in this thing. I have a sense of in 1935, we would have protested the Nuremberg laws and marched in Berlin and invited the Niemöllers and all those ministers and priests to join with us at that time. Maybe the Nazis would have killed 5,000 of us and that would have been the end of it. But, you know, today, we allowed this to happen, tomorrow we allowed this to happen, as long as it didn't touch us. So there was a certain amount of cowardice. And the other thing that was difficult, which was not standing up and saying to a Nazi, do you realize what you're doing to yourself when you do this? You know, you're also created by God. We had a sense that it doesn't pay to talk to a goy. You know, and they felt that we are also subhuman. So we thought them, we read each other out of the human family. That's a bad one.
Do other religions have anything to say about the Holocaust?
You see, for Christianity, everything gets covered by the death of Jesus. Remember that tumult that happened when someone wanted to save the soul of Eichmann and see that he would be forgiven, and Jews were upset about this business. Look at the thing that happened with the chapel at Auschwitz, the Carmelite nuns. I wrote at that time for the New York Times that I felt that a letter to the editor, that instead of complaining that there are some nuns who are praying for raising the souls of the people who died there, we should have our own yeshiva there instead of saying get rid of them. You know, that whole strikes me as if an important lesson of collaboration with other people of goodwill on the planet, that we haven't done so, that we have, they're goyim, we don't want to have anything to do with them. One of the pictures you have over there is when we did the Seder, and there was this imam from Jericho who joined us at that Seder. And somebody from the Israeli radio put him in a compromising position to ask him, you're coming to the Seder, we are saying next year in Jerusalem, what have you got to say about that? So he answered in a gentle way, he says, if there's room for me here too, then I'm very glad. But I lost my cool at this point. I said, how dare you, compromise my guest. You know, sometimes his life is in danger if he's going to say something good and he's going to say something bad. How could you do that, you know? And was upset at our own people that there wasn't the reaching out and inclusiveness, that there is this sense of wanting to be harsh. As if, I kept saying, it looks to me that Jews are going around with an unpaid bill and they're looking from whom they can collect it. And I think that lots of people go with unpaid bills and we somehow have to decide that we aren't going to go collect on that bill.
Do you speak with non-Jews about the Holocaust?
I did often, when I was at Temple University with Professor Littell, who was my colleague in this work, yes.
What are your thoughts on reincarnation and the Holocaust?
One of my students, Jonasson Gershon, wrote a book, Beyond the Ashes. I shared this idea with him at the beginning because I met people who were certainly recycled souls, who had experiences happen to them that pointed to that they had gone through a difficult time in their last exit. One such experience happened once in Berkeley. We were doing a service and we were doing a practice of the fire breath. And one of our people went into a break in which he felt he was choking in the gas chambers. He had not spoken Yiddish and he began to shout in Yiddish, Lo mi arroz von danet, you know? Ich will nicht sterben. And so we had to take him, and we didn't take him to a hospital because otherwise he would have been there for 6 months with that break. We calmed him down, we fed him, we gave him a warm bath and brought him slowly back. But he had gone back. Somehow the breath had gotten him into that place where he was vulnerable. And so, yes, I really believe that there are such people there. And some of them have gone into spiritual work, and some of them have gone into political work, as if to say, last time around they said, if I ever get another chance at life, I'm going to do something about it.
What do you see as the greatest challenge to Jews in light of the Holocaust?
Not to digest it right. You know, if we were to digest it right, I haven't yet seen a meeting, even after past 50 years, that there should be a meeting of Jewish theologians to really work through the meaning of that. Yes, there were some books in the beginning. Richard Rubinstein, was my colleague, had written after Auschwitz, and there were some other people. And Elie Wiesel, although he didn't write theology, had some important things to say that have bearing on theology. But I don't have a sense that we have done collectively the thing to say, to even enshrine it in new liturgy, to say, you know, the Yom HaShoah is still not dealing with it in this way. My sense is that when Rwanda is happening and we as Jews don't stand up for the people who are being slaughtered, then somehow we haven't done something. Take a look how we digested Egypt. We were slaves in Egypt, therefore you have to treat the stranger right. You mustn't enslave other people. There's a whole series of legislation that come out of our experience in Egypt. I don't see that we have so digested the Holocaust material.
In light of assimilation and intermarriage and general changes within the American Jewish community, what do you see?
A lot of people get freaked out about this intermarriage. They should take a look at the number of intermarrieds who participate in the Jewish renewal congregations, who raise their children Jewish, and so on. Like a person who has had a grave injury and one of his organs has died off, we need a transplant, and we are getting a lot of transplants. So very often it is the non-Jewish partner who is a more spiritual one, who creates a better Jewish home than the Jewish partner in there. So I just don't feel that I want to get freaked out by this. If the thing about that I know that whenever there is something that's genuine and that's good and attractive, people get attracted to it. Many of the suburban congregations are not good, not attractive. They're holding tanks, as it were, for bar mitzvahs and so on and so forth. It's a pity. So if we had a better product, we wouldn't have to worry so much about assimilation. Then there is a whole group of people that Gene Houston calls the psychosomatic people, the people who have sort of a psychological bent toward Judaism and who want to be our friends. and want to rub shoulders with us. And words like maven, you know, and bagels are now, and so on and so forth. All that stuff is happening in our culture. So I don't know whether we should weep for that or reinforce such a thing and create an easy access, like ramps, as it were, for people who are psycho-Semitic to participate more with us and to reach out more with us.
What role does forgiveness play in light of the Holocaust?
Anyone who stays on the side of not forgiving is like a jailer who keeps the one whom he has to forgive in the jail of his own contempt in his heart. That jails cost us a lot of money, time and energy and personnel to keep people in jail. We would get a lot more energy freed up if we could let people, if we had more forgiveness going on. The problem is that we don't know how to do it right. And we have made a virtue of not forgiving and not forgetting. My sense is that not forgetting is important. Not forgiving keeps us in trouble. I've spent time in Germany, taught at Tübingen at the university. It was a wonderful time that I had there. And I find young Germans who are now interested in klezmer music, like how they pronounce it, and everything Jewish, and they have spirituality around them. Not all of them, not saying everybody, but why not take hold of the people who do show that? I have some students. One of them is now in Israel. He's a Protestant minister, got himself a PhD writing about Karl Barth's relationship to Judaism, can read Hebrew with perfection, knows how to daven, was with me in Poland, wore tallis and tefillin with me, and is a Protestant minister, and I don't want to see him convert to Judaism. I think he belongs where he is, and he's going to be very effective a person. So my sense is that this collaborative thing is what's being called for, and our learning from the Holocaust should lead to that.
What would you like to tell future generations?
Enjoy life and be honest to yourself. Love this wonderful world of ours. Make sure it's a good place to live in. And I think that Yiddishkeit is really, really the cat's meow, you know. It's the best religion that I know. At this point for us, I'm not saying for everybody, I think it's the most organic and most Gaian of religions. If you start looking at all the laws that go from preserving the trees to how to treat animals and how to celebrate the seasons of the year, which Pesach always coming out on the full moon of the vernal equinox, and that's the sun and the moon in collaboration together in the calendar. The only calendar that I know is both solar and lunar in the world. I think we got such a wonderful thing, and I'd like to see, just as I have done with what I got from my past, I'd like to see my kinderlech do with what they get from me, to bring it further into a time that we hope for is going to be a good time for everybody. Amen.
What would you like your legacy to be?
There was a wonderful Hasidic master by the name of Reb Noach Lechwitzer, who once was asked by his Hasidim after his father, Reb Moshe Lechwitzer, had died. So his Hasidim asked him, Rebbe, why don't you do like my father, like your father did? And he says, I do like my father did. My father didn't ape anyone, and I don't ape anyone, you know. So I think my legacy should be that just as I did what I did, that you do what you need to do and do it with integrity, and that's just good.
Is there anything else you'd like to add in closing? Mm-hmm.
Yes, I want to give a yashar koach to the people who are arranged for this opportunity, and anyone who's going to see it, I just want you to have a blessing, and being able to share with you this way was for me a delight. At the beginning of this thing, I had the flash that people say that before you die, you see the whole, your whole life spread out before you, and that here I had an opportunity that was not fatal, and still to be able to do that, for which I'm very grateful.
Thank you.
These are pictures of me, Rabbi Zalman Schacter-Shalomi. And this montage of pictures is what my sister put together from the many faces of Zalman. I see one picture here where I wear a gray Hamburg, and that was taken in Manitoba when I first got there. In between, you have pictures with various hats on, some of them with the Streimel and the Payas, and that was a phase in my life. And then there are some others that sort of celebrate more my interaction with the people at the Aquarian Meaning of Berkeley. In one of these pictures, I am with a hat, a narrow picture. I am with a hat that is sort of a Sufi hat. It's the way the picture way on top. And in one, I'm playing a flute. So these are pictures of various stages in my life that my sister got from me and then mounted here.
Thank you.
In this picture, in the foreground, is Rabbi Shlomo Karlebach, and I am standing next to him, my hand over his heart. We had just completed doing a seminar together at Lama Foundation in New Mexico, and we were both blissed out at how wonderful things were.
And your name?
My name is Rabbi Zalman Schacter-Shalomi, and this photo was taken, I think, in about the late 70s.
In what country?
In the United States, in Lama Foundation in New Mexico.
Thank you.
On a merry-go-round at the Fellowship House Farm out near Pottstown, Pennsylvania, we were celebrating Simchas Torah, and the kids were just sitting on this merry-go-round, and Reuven Modek, the gentleman who stands there with his red shirt, was the one who was turning that merry-go-round. The kids were having fun, and since we were dancing with the Torah, I was holding the Torah on that merry-go-round.
In what year?
The year must have been 1979.
In what country?
In the United States, in Pottstown, Pennsylvania.
And the person holding the Torah?
Is Rabbi Zalman Schacter-Shalomi.
Thank you.
This is a picture of Chaya Gittel Schechter. She is my mother, and this picture was taken just a few weeks before she was passing out.
In what country?
This was taken in Israel, and she is sitting in the room where she spent her last year, at the desk where she would from time to time write letters to her children and grandchildren.
In what year was this taken?
This was taken in 1989. On the right is the Lubavitcher Rebbe, Reb Menachem Mendel Schneerson, giving out dollar bills. I receive one from him. I am Rabbi Zalman Schacter-Shalomi. The year this was taken in Brooklyn at the 770 Eastern Parkway headquarters, and the year must have been the year 1989.
Thank you.
Sure, it's I, Rabbi Zalman Schacter-Shalomi, after I was conducting a high holiday service at Mount Madonna in California near Watsonville, California. The year must have been 1987. And, yeah.
Thank you.
On the left is Eve Ilson, my wife, receiving a kiss from me, Rabbi Zalman Schacter-Shalomi. This picture was taken in Florida, in all likelihood in 1992.
Thank you.
This is a picture taken in Jerusalem. In the center, I'm standing, Rabbi Zalman Schacter-Shalomi. Next to me, at what is at the left of the picture, is Imam Abdo, a Muslim teacher and clergy person from Jericho. Now, on the Palestinian side, he came to participate in this Passover Seder. Next to me on my What would be on the right of the picture is Eve Ilsen, my wife, and that couple are two clergy people from Africa who participated, and they are Christians. Sorry, I don't recall their names.
In what year?
And the year, in all likelihood, is 1994.
Thank you.
To the left is a bodyguard who I don't remember, but His Holiness the Dalai Lama in the center with his red robe is pulling my beard and being delighted that we meet again. And he was saying, shouting out loud, the Jewish, remembering how he had met me, Rabbi Zalman Schacter-Shalomi, at Dharamsala. In between our noses is Eve Ilsen, my wife, grinning and having fun watching the two of us.
And where was this taken?
And this was taken here at Boulder last summer, 1996.
Thank you.